Welcome once again to Cinemaholics, where we talk about the biggest and best films coming to theaters and streaming online from the San Francisco Bay Area. I'm John Negroni, film editor for the young folks from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. He's the pop culture writer for Cinema Bland, and he hates sand. It gets everywhere. It's Will Ashton.
Wow. I couldn't think of a Dune quote, so I just was thinking of the Hans Zimmer, like...
Yeah, you just wanted to be Hans.
Yeah, just the wan sound that comes out every few minutes in the movie, which I like a lot, but we'll discuss that in a bit.
Yeah, we're talking about Dune today, and what else are we talking about, Will Ashton? What are the other two flicks?
Yeah, we're talking about French Dispatch, the new Wes Anderson film, his 10th film, and we're going to be discussing, what is it? Ron Gone Wrong.
Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah,
a new animated film.
Yeah, it's not a memorable title, but it has nothing to say about my opinion about the rest of the film.
Okay, fair enough. Hey, yeah, we're going to talk about all three of these movies. Big one is Dune, and there's so much to get into with Dune. It's a big movie, and it's a big deal. This month, so many movies, so many big movies. We were talking off the air, like, oh my gosh, there's so many movies coming out. How are we going to fit them all into Cinemaholics? Well, you can help us out. Because, well, first of all, you can find more episodes, the reviews we've already done on cinemaholics.com, everything, full archive, including written reviews and other bonus content, including, you know, video reviews. Well, did you know we do video reviews on cinemaholics.com now? Did you know that?
Yeah, you've been doing that recently. That's fun.
Yeah, without talking to you about it?
Yeah.
I just started doing it.
Yeah.
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 So I started doing that. No, I knew I wanted to re-kickstart my YouTube channel, and I've been publishing them on Cinemaholics, and they're fun. If you want earlier reviews than usual, like if you're like, okay, I can't wait to hear what, you know, John has to say. It's just John. Will isn't on the YouTube channel yet.
Yeah.
But if you want to hear what I have to say about like Eternals, for example, the review for that just went live last night.
Mm-hmm.
It's there. So you can check it out if you want, but you know, it's up to you.
Mm-hmm.
You can also write into the show, send us an email, cinemaholicspodcast@gmail.com is how you do that. If you'd like to support our show, which is what I was getting to earlier, there is our Patreon, patreon.com/cinemaholics. And you could also leave us a 5-star rating on Apple Podcasts or Stitcher. That'd be super cool, super nice. And then, yeah, check out the Cinemaholics merch as well. The classic logo is on a hoodie, a mug, a t-shirt, a shot glass, whatever you can think of. And of course, if you're like, well, how do I find this stuff? It's in the show notes. Just scroll down, you know, tap your finger and you're there. But this week, I feel like there's so much to discuss in terms of new movies that we don't have time for off topics. We got to get right into it.
I mean, if
we did, we would probably talk about the Alec Baldwin thing.
Yeah, that's a big thing. If we have more time, we can discuss that later date. But yeah, that's just there's nothing.
A big topic. Yeah,
I mean, there's a lot to say, but
safety.
It's not really like a fun discussion. It's just really, really sad. But I mean, there was also broadcast signal intrusion, which I watched ahead of the show before I was told by you that I didn't need to do that. So
did I tell you though that we were going to talk about it?
Well,
we talked about it. Like, oh, that might come out.
Yeah. Well,
and you're like, great, I'll watch it. I'll be like, what? And you're like, I just watched it, John. What?
Well, yeah. I mean, I was saying like, what are we covering? And I was like, should we be covering these four films? And then you're like, yeah, we should probably cover all four. And then I watched the fourth one.
Did I say all four? Sorry.
Yeah. You said all four films. So I don't know. I mean, I didn't have a lot to say about it. I thought it was okay.
I saw it ages ago, so I barely remember it. It didn't really register with me. It's spooky season, right? You were probably able to add it to your 31 Days of Horror?
I did, yeah. I'm going to add it to that. But, I mean, my whole thing, though, is that I saw half of it at South by Southwest or on the, the website for it, and my link expired before I could finish it. So without giving away too much about the film, it's a lot of like setup, or it's like kind of like this building mystery, and I was very intrigued, and that's why I wanted to
all
finish
this
it
time. Finish months it. And months of like this mystery, this must be an amazing payoff. I've been waiting and waiting.
Well,
and it's,
I saw the rest of reviews and I knew it wasn't like amazing, but I was intrigued. I was like, well, maybe the payoff is pretty good. And I felt like, you know, watching that and then rewatching those scenes and leading up to the second half of the film, I was like, maybe this is like, you know, it's going to build up something cool. And it doesn't, I guess, without, like I said, giving anything away. It just kind of ends.
Okay.
Yeah. It's just like, oh, well, I don't really know what the point of all that was. But I'm sure there's, you know, I mean, I get like the broader point. I don't really get the desire to make the film, I guess. But I mean, it's not a bad film or anything.
It's not bad at all.
It's just kind of fine.
I hope we can have a conversation at a later date about horror movies in 2021, because I've been very disappointed, but I don't know if everybody has been. There are very few like horror movies I can look at that I'm like, man, that was one of my favorite movies of the year. There's almost none probably. So
yeah, I mean,
I don't know if it's been a good year for horror.
I guess not. I mean, there's been some stuff, I guess, if you count Titane, which I do, is like a body horror
film.
I
don't know if I count that as, it's like, yeah, I don't know.
But we didn't see Lamb, which I've heard mixed things about. That was a big horror film. I saw Antlers, which I don't know if we're discussing for a bonus episode next week, but I thought that was all right.
There's also Last Night in Soho, which I don't want to get ahead of ourselves. We're going to do a review for that later this week. But that is technically a horror film, like the second half of it. And I was super disappointed by Last Night in Soho.
Yeah,
so I mean, we'll talk about it.
Malignant was pretty fun. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, but even then, that's a movie that I didn't really get into until the very end.
Sure.
Conjuring 3 was kind of a big disappointment.
That was
Knock Knock and Censor. Yeah, I don't know. Nighthouse was okay. One of the better ones, I guess, but it still wasn't that great. I don't know, man.
I think you mean Knocking. Knock Knock is the Eli Roth film.
Eli Roth. Yeah. I'm talking about Knocking.
Right,
the
Knocking.
Sundance.
Yeah, very forgettable film. So as you suggested, but yeah, I don't know, maybe that new Paranormal Activity movie that they're dumping on Paramount Plus is like secretly amazing. Probably not, but who knows.
Probably not. I don't know how to tell you this. I think it's gonna be pretty bad, but I hope not. I mean, I would be over the moon if we got an awesome Paranormal Activity movie. I love those.
Are you a fan? Yeah,
movies.
I was gonna say, you like
every
those.
Other one.
Yeah,
it's like the Daniel Craig James Bond movies. It's like every other one. Like the first Paranormal Activity, great. Third one's the best.
Yeah,
probably
third
the
one's,
best.
I would say the good one. And then the rest, I'm kind of like, I mean, the first one I respect. And the second one, I'm kind of in the same camp. I'm like, yeah.
First
I mean,
one's respectable. The fifth one is actually, like the fourth one's pretty bad.
That's
the fifth one I actually think is the one that comes close to rivaling the third one.
Really? I thought the fifth one was the worst one. That's the 3D one,
marked
right?
ones?
No, wait, no. That one I liked. I thought that's like the spinoff, though.
Yeah.
I was talking about the 3D one that I think, like the last one before this one that was like
the Dimension one. Yeah,
whatever. That was
that's the worst one.
That's awful. Yeah, that one sucked. The fourth one was just sort of like whatever. And then I did like, I like marked ones and I like the third movie. The rest I'm kind of give or take outside the first film.
The fourth one's not terrible. Like the fourth one is just kind of, it has like a good ending at least, but like it's a kind of a bit of a slog, has a very predictable twist. Yeah, it's not great, but I like the movies. Like I like them in like half, you know, so I guess we're due for a good one, right?
I mean,
hopefully
the one, like I said, I'm pretty sure this movie's gonna suck. I can't imagine they would just put it on Paramount Plus if it was like amazing. But the one advantage I think to watching at home is that they kind of work better at home anyway. Like if you're like watching them, like you're discovering found footage.
I love the Paranormal Activity crowd that I used to go to the movies to see. I mean, the only one of these I did see, I saw Marked Ones and I saw Ghost Dimension in California, but the other ones I saw in a theater in Virginia, and that was, oh boy.
I mean,
that's a fun experience. People get scared.
Yeah. I mean, to your point, I think the only ones I saw like with an actual crowd were the third one and Marked Ones, which were my favorite. So you might have a fair point to that.
It might just be a correlation of the fact that those had some buzz around them. I don't know. But yeah, the third one, when you get to that like final act and then you're in the theater. I mean, the first one too. The first one had that like novelty factor, right? Like we didn't know what we were in for. And I remember seeing that in like midnight screening. I was on a date and like there were only like four other people in there. Oh boy. No, but like everybody in that theater was like, I hate this. I don't want to be here. And I'm sitting there being like, this is amazing. I didn't sleep for weeks. It was so great.
I mean, at the very least, I think the first one is an amazing underdog story as far as like being whatever the budget was for that film, like $20,000, making like 100 million plus, like well over its budget. I mean, that's like just incredible. I think that's, you know, the true victory of that series. So, I mean, outside of how I feel about the films on a whole, but Yeah, I don't know. This new one's probably going to suck. I think we can stop talking about.
I think we talked ourselves into watching it now. I mean, now that we kind of did off topics by accident about it. So
if at least two people are interested in hearing our thoughts, I think we'll do a bonus episode. How about that?
There we go. Yeah. Email us cinemahawkspodcast@gmail.com or drop us a line on Twitter or whatever. Please let us know. Is it worth covering? So I would like to give it a shot, but we'll see if that actually happens. All right. We have three pretty decent sized movies to get into, so I don't want to waste any more time. And not waste time, but, you know, I don't want to lose any more time because Dune is a long movie.
Hey, Cinemaholic. So sorry to interrupt myself, but real quick, gotta say, the Dune review is about to happen. We're going to talk about Dune. It's phenomenal. It's quite a review. We talk about in this review something that I have to clear up here at the start, that there is going to be a sequel. Dune 2, Dune Part 2 is going to happen. And we didn't know that while we were recording. The news broke literally while we were putting the bells and whistles. Like, Will Ashton was just finishing up the printing press. He had just put on the seal. I had just, you know, beckoned the editor-in-chief. We're like, we got this. This thing's rolling out. So we're doing this, like, last-minute disclaimer. The news broke. There's going to be a sequel. So when you hear us talking about, like, is there going to be a sequel? It's not a pointless conversation, but that is why it's instantly dated. It's very embarrassing, even more embarrassing than usual for us. But I hope this disclaimer will calm you down, keep you afloat, and we can just get right back into the review. Let's do this thing.
Dune is our first review this week, and it is a big, big deal. I mean, this movie, a lot of people were looking at Dune and they were saying, if this movie is successful or it's not successful, it could mean a lot of big things for Warner Brothers and for the industry. Do you agree with that, Will? Do you think the stakes were high with Dune?
Yeah, I mean, for obvious reasons, obviously, like, there was a lot put into it. It's not like it's an original property. Obviously, it's based on Frank Herbert's foundational book as far as how it influenced the sci-fi genre moving forward. Yeah. But
it's a 1965 novel.
Yeah.
Well, it's old.
I mean, I don't know if we need to get into the whole history of why Dune is such a, you know, foundational text, as I mentioned. But I mean, the long and short of it is just that it's this really big book that is really key to, like, how world building is perceived now. I mean, certainly its influence, I think indirectly, was really big as far as, like, influencing like a movie like Star Wars. Like, I think you don't have Star Wars without Dune.
You do not. The two big inspirations are Dune, or there are three big inspirations: Dune, Flash Gordon, and Kurosawa. Like, those are the three. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, I mean, it's kind of like a weird John Carter situation where it's like, I mean, obviously there was the Dune movie from David Lynch in the '80s, and I think there are other, like, adaptations. Like, was there, like, a show?
There was a miniseries. Yeah, like 20 years ago. I never saw it, but I heard it's actually pretty competent. Like, people go to bat for that miniseries, apparently. I've never seen it.
Where did that air?
I have no idea.
Okay. I just didn't know. I was just learning about that this week, so I'm not too familiar with it. But, yeah.
I forgot. I mean, I kind of remember it because people have been talking about remaking Dune for years. There was the Alexander Todorovsky Dune that was supposed to be a thing. I remember, like, we talked about it a little bit. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you and I talked about it when we were talking about Alien, because when David Lynch eventually got Dune, there was, like, Alien was kind of like the precursor to, can we pull off a movie like this?
Yes.
And can, you know, Ridley Scott was given that project. He was heavily inspired by some of the pre-production that was going into Todorovsky's Dune. So yeah, I mean, it's an important movie, but it's not a movie that I think everybody's seen and sunk their teeth into, their sandworm teeth into, I guess.
Well, I mean, the Hodorowski film, as you mentioned, I think that's kind of where I was talking about with the Star Wars thing, where, like, even though that movie wasn't made, as you see in the documentary, like, the storyboards and stuff were very keenly influencing how the visual aesthetic of Star Wars was made and all that. So, yeah, I mean, even if, like, outside of just the book itself, just, like, the attempts to bring this movie to the screen have been influential in their own weird, indirect sort of way. So, yeah, I mean, the fact that we actually have, like, a big, bold, faithful adaptation of the text coming to the screen, that's a big deal for sci-fi fans, obviously. But also, like you say, like, having another property like this where, like, if this does well, you know, this is our next big, huge franchise. Like, people are putting the same claims into this as, like, maybe this is our next Lord of the Rings. Maybe this is our next, like, whatever, you know, in terms of franchises and stuff. So, I mean, I don't know how far this is going to go as far as, like, Denis Villeneuve's involvement. I don't know if he's going to stay past a intended second film of this, but you know, clearly with all the books that are at their disposal from Frank Herbert's collection, you know, this could very well go on to be a very big franchise if this is as successful as they hope.
Two things to be clear on. This is a part one. So if we did get one more movie, at least it would just be finishing the first book. But to your point, yeah, they could keep it going after that. And I think that at the very least, secondly, Denis Villeneuve would do the second one. Like, that was the plan. I think the issue, the reason they didn't Lord of the Rings this, where they do all three movies back to back and just do it, even though they don't know if it's going to be successful, is really because Dune, it's too ambitious. Like, it would have been too much work to do the movies back to back. I mean, it's already hard to do that anyway, but logistically, like, they wouldn't have been able to secure like all the actors. They wouldn't have been able to just handle all of the bulk of the pre-production in time to make both of these movies in one go. So that's kind of why we are where we are.
Yeah. I mean, I guess the most comparable would be like It, as far as like just kind of doing the first half of it and then being like, we would like to do a second one. We haven't greenlit yet, but if you guys like this, please come out to see it, because then we can get the financing to do the second one. So, but yeah, I mean, you know, I know this is kind of a relic of its time in many respects, but also like that trend that we saw like in the early 2010s, where they would just split books in half, sometimes quite egregiously, like with the Hunger Games film.
Yeah, Mockingjay Part 1. That was like a 200-page book split in two. It's pretty sad.
Yeah, I think the most egregious and funniest example was the last Divergent film, which was...
Right, which never even got its part 2.
Yeah, they never even got its Part 2, which is so funny.
It was at least smart, though. It's like they figured out they couldn't just say Part 1, Part 2 at that point. They were like, well, we can't call it Allegiant Part 1. They had to do whatever it was. Yeah. But
algorithm or whatever.
Yeah, they just gave it a different title.
Yeah,
that's all they did. And then I think they were supposed to like add extra content to the books, which is like, yeah, that makes sense. You could do that. And then like Avengers Infinity War, Avengers Endgame, Justice League, like those were all supposed to be like Part 1, Part 2, because they were taking a cue from Harry Potter. Like, that's where this really kind of became a, hey, maybe this is the way to do this kind of thing.
I mean, obviously, I think there's also like the Game of Thrones influence coming around this time as well. Like, just like, you know, having like these huge books that, you know, were split up into like this big longstanding series. Like, obviously, it's been done before in TV, but like, weirdly, like, Dune was so influential to like George R. R. Martin, but then like, you know, the Game of Thrones, that's probably like a big reason why we have Dune now. So it's like kind of a weird cyclical kind of thing going on there, but that's neither here nor there.
Mm. I don't know if I would go that far. I think Martin, Game of Thrones for him, A Song of Ice and Fire wasn't really, the thing about Martin is he had a huge like sci-fi, you know, background. Like, he did fantasy and then, and of course, like Game of Thrones and A Song of Ice and Fire, like that was his like bread and butter eventually. But a lot of his sci-fi bona fides were really developed in like the 1950s and the 1960s. But that's actually a good pivot into, I think, a unique thing about Dune and the 1965 era, is that like up until that point, sci-fi wasn't like this. Like, when we say Dune influenced Star Wars, we're not talking about sheer sci-fi. We're talking about the idea of having like a desert planet and having like low budget, like lo-fi technology, but in a space futuristic setting. Mm-hmm. Like, that very much is what Frank Herbert helped sort of like bring about in a big way, because before that we had things like, we had Philip K. Dick, we had sci-fi that was very like robots, and we had like the Blade Runner stuff, I guess. We had what Philip K. Dick was like the Android Dream of Electric Sheep. I should be more specific, but we had space, and we had like Star Trek, right?
Pretty much
like that kind of like sci-fi world where it's like super high tech, super advanced civilizations. Jetsons, thank you.
Yeah.
Whereas like this stuff is more of like, what if it was the Bible, but with space, you know, like, basically, and that's where you have Dune.
I mean, if you're looking at him like as a space messiah, sure. I mean, Frank Herbert obviously took a lot from like a lot of religions and texts and all that to make Dune.
For sure.
But yeah, religion, as far as like Catholicism, is certainly a big part of it for sure.
Which was radical for the time, because sci-fi at that point and space, like this stuff used to be fully associated with hard science and logic and that sort of thing. It wasn't something that religion really delved into as much. Like this idea of like a cosmic force, like in Star Wars, like that is what really Dune helped establish and validate as you could do something like this. Like this is actually something that these are things that go well together. This is peanut butter cup, you know, Reese's and all that. But we mentioned Denis Villeneuve. He's the director of this film. I think this film, in my opinion, is going to solidify him as the big budget sci-fi director. This is his third one in terms of sci-fi because he did Arrival, which wasn't like a massive movie, but it was a big deal. It hit pop culture. It's still memeified today. It won some Oscars. Yeah. I mean, yeah, Amy Adams, terrific performance from her in it. Mm-hmm. And it had some big ideas. It was just adapting like a short story, though. In terms of scope, it was kind of a small movie compared to when he does Blade Runner 2049, which is this massive expansion of the 1980s Blade Runner. Mm-hmm. And 2049, which I maintain, one of the actual like all-time great sci-fi movies of the modern era. I was actually re-listening to our conversation about Blade Runner 2049, and I'm like, man, my enthusiasm for this movie has not waned one bit. I was all in on Blade Runner 2049 back in 2017. I still am.
It's a good film. I like it a lot.
It's so good, and I'm due for a rewatch, that's for sure. Now, sure. That said, I bring that up because I've been curious, like, how is Dune going to do, right? Blade Runner 2049.
Dune.
Yeah. This movie... Blade Runner 2049, it wasn't like a flop. Like it probably lost some money, but it didn't lose a ton of money. It made something around $260 million. Its budget is ballpark about half of that. So it made about double its budget, but I think a lot of that's international. I think it was in the red, but it wasn't like an egregious, like, oh my gosh. Like it's not like The Last Duel, which is currently flailing in the box office right now.
Yeah, I mean, the weird thing about Denis Villeneuve is that, like, he's such a big name as far as his critic accolades, and, like, he has, like, a clear, like, fan base at this point, but his films, I mean, like, Arrival and Sicario and Prisoners, I think they all did well, but they weren't, like, huge hits. Like, I mean, I think they just did, like, they got probably out of the red, but not, like, they weren't, you know, very lucrative. I guess Sicario was lucrative enough to get a sequel, but
yeah.
Yeah. I mean, like,
he hasn't had his Dark Knight yet. Right.
Right. Yeah.
He's like a Christopher Nolan sort of successor. I wouldn't say successor, but he kind of is a similar sort of guy in terms of like his movies are expected to be spectacular. They're expected to be spectacle machines at this mm-hmm. point. Like he's building that reputation. He started with smaller films and now he's expanding, but he hasn't adapted, I think purposely so, he hasn't adapted something as popular as like Batman that's going to be super well received. I think Dune is one of the bigger attempts he's making to carve out a franchise.
I would argue there's certainly, I mean, Blade Runner is such a huge property that, you know, I mean, I like that he it wasn't like a Colin Trevorrow thing where he just like went from like micro indie, like Incendies to Blade Runner 2049. He like, you know, clearly did his homework. He built his way up to something like this. And I think you know, it feels like you can tell, like, just like you said, like all the films that he made leading up to this feel like if you look at it, like it does feel like an escalator up to like this, because clearly he's wanted to do this film for a long time. This is a very big passion project for him. He's not coming into this as like a director for hire, like, oh yeah, like, you know, it's not like David Lynch just being like, yeah, I guess I can do something with this. Like, he clearly is very passionate about this, has wanted to tell the story, is very adamant that people see in theaters and support it so that he can make the second film and complete the story, at least as far as the first book is concerned. And yeah. I mean, I think it definitely is a successful story as far as like a director really building his brand and getting to make this big adaptation that he's wanted to make since probably childhood. So in that respect, it is a success.
You can tell Warner Brothers has put a lot of faith into this movie being a success for them. I think that you can see it in all of the marketing weight they put behind it, a huge risk, of course. They premiered it at the Venice International Film Festival. Clearly they wanted Dune. They want Dune to really hit people. They want people to watch this thing. And so far, people are obliging. It's already made almost as much as Blade Runner 2049 one weekend. We'll get to that a little bit later, but let's talk about the actual movie. So Dune Part One, if you want to call it that, which we might as well, is it covers about the first half of the first book, which I think you've read around the first half of the first book. I have too, so I'm aware I know what happens because of the David Lynch movie. I mean, I shouldn't say that, because do any of us really know what happened in the David Lynch movie?
Sure.
it's a bizarre film. I encourage people to seek it out, but it requires a lot of patience and a curiosity for film history that you have to bring to it. I'll put it that way.
I believe it's streaming on HBO Max at the moment, I believe, right?
I'm not sure. That would be very convenient. You could just kind of check that out after you see this Dune. Although I kind of went into this almost a blank slate in terms. I mean, I know Dune enough. Like, I understand like the basics and everything. But I mean, the book doesn't really hold your hand. I still felt like the film would educate me a lot on the fine details of this universe, if that makes sense. And I think that is what ended up happening. There are some things from the book I didn't fully understand that the movie kind of crystallized a little bit. But at the same time, I think the movie's also skewing a lot. It's simplifying a lot of what happens in the book and almost translating it to like a more refined cinematic presentation.
Yeah, it threads a lot of the material in a way that I think, as an adaptation, I think it is fairly successful, because I think you read Dune and it's like, I mean, like you said, I'm maybe almost 300 pages into it and I get the gist of it, but there's a lot of stuff I just kind of have to like assume I'm getting as far as like conception or like visualization of it. But yeah, I mean, I think as far as like bringing this story to a wide audience and making it comprehensive enough to understand while also being idiosyncratic enough to respect the material, I think that's something this movie does incredibly well, and something I have to really respect Denis Villeneuve for accomplishing, and the screenwriters as well, obviously, because that is certainly not an easy thing to do with a text like this.
Absolutely. The other screenwriters are John Spates and Eric Roth, and I think that for the most part, I think the screenplay in terms of where things go and where things are, I always understood what was happening in this movie. I always understood what characters wanted, what they were trying to do. I mean, without getting too far ahead of myself, I don't think the writing, though, is pitch perfect. I think that there are a lot of beats that I thought were confoundingly dumb in terms of like dialogue and.
You mean in the movie or in the book?
In the movie. Yeah, I'm talking about the screenplay strictly. But sure. Real quick, we'll say the setup here, it's not that complicated, I don't think. I mean, I think what gets complicated is more of the lore. But in terms of the setup, it's pretty easy to follow. We kind of already mentioned it's like a space messiah story. The idea is that we're 10,000 years in the future. Mankind has reached the stars. We have interstellar travel. But the only way that we can have interstellar travel is the use of this powerful spice that can basically get you high. It's like a drug, but it can also make ships go zoom. So there is that. And the spice is only available.
It's like gas and weed at the same time, and beer.
Yeah, exactly. You can and you can only find it in one place, this desert planet called Arrakis. Now, there's this emperor of the whole galaxy. We don't meet him in this movie or her. I don't know what they're going to do for that. But the emperor of the galaxy sort of manipulates a bit of a feudal war. That's where the Game of Thrones comparisons can kind of be made. There's the noble House Stark, the House Atreides, led by Oscar Isaac, and he has a son with his concubine. His concubine is played by Rebecca Ferguson. His son Paul is played by Timothy Chalamet. Paul is the sort of Jesus figure here, because on the one hand, he's like the noble son of a noble house. They've been tasked by the emperor to go to Arrakis and bring this planet under control, because even though the spice is there and it's a desert planet, it's not heavily inhabited. It is inhabited by dangerous forces, these massive sandworms that can basically follow human footsteps extremely easily. And so it's very dangerous to try to mine resources. The environment is not hospitable. It's very difficult to survive. But there is a faction on this planet called the Fremen. And Paul, even though he's never been to Arrakis, he keeps having these visions, these dreams of him being on Arrakis ahead of time. It's, why is that happening? And we sort of find out that he has these special space powers because of his mother, played by Rebecca Ferguson, who has been training him all his life in a very, you know, Mary, the Virgin Mary kind of fashion to be this sort of like powerful messianic figure who's going to save everyone. And eventually they go to Arrakis, but it's not going to be so easy because there is another feuding war. This house led by Stellan Skarsgård. I almost said Bill Skarsgård because he was in Eternals. But Stellan Skarsgård as the unbelievably villainous Mad Max-esque baron who can like levitate, and he's hideous, but he's also extremely powerful. Dave Bautista is his fist, you know, his right hand. And they're here to try to get the spice for themselves and get the Emperor's favor. We also have Jason Momoa on Team House Atreides, you know, coming in there as a Poe Dameron.
Yeah, I was gonna say he has my favorite name in the movie and the book, which is Duncan Idaho, because I love that, you know, like we have like these like exotic, weird, far out names, and then we have characters like Paul and Jessica and Duncan Idaho, which I find very amusing.
Which again, yeah, I think of Star Wars, you know, Luke Skywalker. It's kind of a funny thing.
Yeah, I get that. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, we also have Charlotte Rampling in this movie. Josh Brolin is kind of this man-at-arms character. There's a lot going on. There's a lot of intrigue. There's a lot of action. I would say that the first part of this movie, to me, is a kind of an extended prologue. It takes us a while to get to Arrakis. If you didn't think that the movie was just going to cover the first part of the book, then by the part one, you kind of get the gist of that once it's like, oh, we're like an hour in and we're not even like the plot hasn't really started yet. We're still doing a lot of setup. This movie is in a lot of ways so much setup. There really are just sort of like building up the big stuff that's going to happen later. Because again, like there are some actors in here like Zendaya and Javier Bardem who they're in the movie, but not a lot. And we get the hints that like, oh, maybe their characters are going to be a little bit more important. I mean, for sure, they're going to be more important. And the next one, which I would say, I'll bet a guarantee, I think that this movie is going to get a part two. I think Villeneuve, based on the critics raving about this movie and the fact that it is making plenty of money, it's made more money during the pandemic from Warner Brothers and I think anything else that's been day and date.
Right. And it's doing well on HBO Max, supposedly. Well, I mean, we don't have the numbers to support that, but apparently it is.
I looked into some of it and I think that it's doing decent on HBO Max. It's doing better in theaters. So there is this sort of, I think the indication based on what I understand is that Warner Brothers is seeing there is an appetite to see this on the big screen, which is probably way more exciting to them, that people are choosing to see this in theaters instead of on HBO Max, or they're doing both, right? And that for them is a good, because even if this first one isn't like a massive hit for them, that means people who watch this in theaters will definitely see it again. So that's and they like it. Right. The scores are great. Like there's good word of mouth. So people will watch another one. And I think that it's going to build traction over time on HBO Max. People are going to read the book. And so this is how you get a sequel that they will hopefully look at as like, we should do the sequel because the sequel could be even bigger.
Right.
Because people are in.
Yeah. I mean, a big thing with sequels, as far as like what you're suggesting, is that like not only is there interest in continuing this, but is there the chance that, like you said, there's renewed interest, like people want and are actively seeking a continuation, it would go out of their way to see it for that reason. So, yeah, I think it would make sense. I'm pretty sure the CEO, if I'm recalling correctly, has said like it's all but guaranteed at this point that they're going to do a second one. So it seems pretty likely it's going to happen.
Absolutely. Especially because they've already done the hard work to get this thing off the ground, because a lot of like with pre-production, a lot of figuring out things is the art direction, the costumes, the tone, how the movie works, how it functions. And they already did that. Like we have that in part one. So there isn't a huge cost in terms of time and resources to keep this thing going, comparatively. So yeah, I think it's a done deal. I think that Villeneuve is going to keep it going. He's going to finish it with part two after that. Who knows? But I doubt we'll get anything else from him on this. I think he'll move on. But probably. I think at the very least, yeah, people are anxious to see what happens next for this story. But as a movie, I mean, this is not a standalone movie. Will, how do you juggle that? I mean, do you sort of have an opinion that feels holistic with this movie anyway?
Yeah, I mean, I see it as pretty at peace with the novel in that, for me, like, reading the book, I feel like it doesn't, like, the plot doesn't really kick in until, like, page 150 or 200 or whatever. It's mostly about kind of establishing the lore and, like you're saying, like, the world building, the sense of, like, what it is like on Arrakis and these otherworldly places and stuff like that. And I respect that Denis Villeneuve is really just getting you into this other place. Like, I think, especially if you see this in theaters, in IMAX or something adjacent to it, you really get the sense of, like, this kind of, like, all-encompassing vibe where you feel like, you know, because the score is so big, it's so, like, theatrical in its presentation and all that, it does feel very, like, encompassing in a way that I think is, you know, obviously very cinematic. And Denis Villeneuve has been like, please see my movie in theaters. Like, I would rather you see my movie in theater, not only because it would support me and support the film and get a sequel, but because that's, you know, how I intended the film to be seen. Also, I feel like that's the most affecting way to see the film. And obviously there are people who can't for various reasons, but I think if you can see in theaters, this is one you should obviously seek out because it is so big and grand, and it feels so singular to something like, even though we have all these films that are going for this, you know, cinematic universes and all this stuff, this feels like it is going for something, you know, to make the obvious comparison, kind of Kubrickian in that sense, like feeling kind of so massive and so all encompassing in its scale and scope. And I think there are obviously issues with that. And I don't think it obviously always works in terms of pacing and stuff. But I think more often than not, when it really hits its stride, it is something to be seen on the big screen. And it can be very affecting in that respect.
I think everything you're saying is what is getting people to the theater, because I think people are picking up on that intuitively, that if they go to the movies, they're making a deal with Warner Brothers here, where, like, I'm going to see something larger than life. I'm going to see a shadow of something I've never seen before. I mean, that's what got them to go see Godzilla versus Kong. They're like, that's what I want to see. I want to see something that can't fit on my small screen. I mean, it can technically, but thematically and emotionally, no. Like, they want that experience. And I think that's going to be Warner Brothers' big lesson from 2021. I mean, look at, if the Suicide Squad had not been such a huge disappointment, I think that they would be doubling down more on, like, well, we got to put all our resources into comic book stuff, not these more like adult-centered films, these films that are inviting people to see something in a format that just doesn't do otherwise, if that makes sense. Suicide Squad, I think people looked at that and are like, I could just watch that at home and I like it. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah, I mean, like I said before, I think the easiest comparison for me is a John Carter, because that was another film, or another book, I mean, John Carter of Mars, where it obviously was so precedent in what it was doing and so influential that when we finally got the movie, it felt like we had already, like, seen however many adaptations, even though it was the first time it was brought to the screen. But I think, you know, it's been,
started the cliches, but there's still cliches now, you know?
Right, exactly. But I think, I mean, it's been a decade since I've seen it, so maybe if I rewatch the film, I would like it more. But I remember at the time, it had an ability to really feel accessible beyond, like, just kind of doing what we expect of these sort of films. Like, there's some great scenes in there, but for the most part, it kind of was going through the motions in a way that, even though it was like kind of the origin in some respects for these type of stories, it just didn't really feel, in terms of its filmmaking, like it was doing anything unique and grand. And I like that this movie is acknowledging that in the sense of, like, okay, we're not really going to be focusing so much on, like, the hero's journey and, you know, telling the story in that respect, but rather just, like, the vibes, you know, for to make it more modern in my terminology, you know, just kind of getting it, like, this sense of the scope and getting the grandness of it and all that, like I said. And I think, you know, I mean, that can make it a little maybe not as fulfilling, because we're only getting half of the story. And I think maybe once you get the second half, it'll be easier to appreciate this first half for that reason. But I think that approach, as far as, like, Denis Villeneuve just getting you into world, appreciating the world, getting to know these characters and stuff like that, but not selling you the whole pie quite yet, I think it was a gamble, but I think for him, I think he did it the right way.
Yeah, for me, I ultimately land positive on this movie, but I definitely have issues with just how, aside from the scope of it, because I think we could definitely agree on that. I think Villeneuve put so much care, attention, and focus on making you see something really epic and feeling immersed. And that's so important. And the fact that he nails that and condenses the story too is pretty, pretty remarkable. But I think my issue, honestly, is that I just did not emotionally hook with anything that was going on here. I think that when it came down to why are we here? What are the moods of this movie? Why do I care about Paul? Why do I care about Duncan, Idaho? Why do I care about the Fremen? I think that it was getting to that. It was getting to the point where, like, this is going to be when the movie comes together and I'm going to suddenly, it's like turning the page and like, I can't stop reading the book of like, I want to see what happens next. I want to see what happens to this character. But I don't think we really get that. We kind of get an extended chase scene in terms of like the driving narrative. And along the way, all of these visual asides of here's Paul in this situation, here's Paul sort of like dreaming and kind of in a trance, and none of it ever really connected for me. I think the opportunity there is you have this story, this political bent to this movie being like, it's in the future. So why is everything regressed to the feudal era? That's where I think like the story kind of needs to build from. But I don't know. I don't, at least on my first viewing, I don't think it does much with that. Like, I didn't know if this movie was really about anything beyond let's do some cool space stuff and weird things happen and wait until the next one. You'll understand why.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, if we're comparing this to Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows Part One, like, obviously, viewers don't have like that love and care that they already established for the protagonists at that point. So it's not like, you know, the fact that they were able to spin their wheels a bit with that film was a luxury because, you know, like they're just, audiences were already caring enough about the books and the films at that point that they have that luxury. But I think, yeah, I mean, there is that established fan base with the novel and stuff. And yeah, I mean, I can get that, like, if you're watching this without much awareness of that, it can feel a bit odd. And I did feel that at times, even having read a chunk of the book, I did kind of feel like, well, you know, in a modern lens, like, I can get why Paul is a big character in the 60s, but like, why should we really care about this dude in a present day lens? And I wish there was a little bit more done to make him more approachable or a little bit more diverse or dynamic in a modern sense. But at the same time, I think the fact the movie cares so much about establishing tone and world and vibe and, you know, making the characters present and giving them some established gravitas, but not focusing so much on them that we have to be, you know, the narrative, the pool of it doesn't have to be crucial to us caring so much about them at this point, I think is successful. But I can understand where you're coming from.
Yeah, I sympathize, honestly, with Villeneuve and the screenwriters, because it's not like they have the luxury of Blade Runner 2049, where you have the freedom, you know, it's a sequel of an adaptation. They had so much room with Blade Runner to sort of build out this Ryan Gosling character who I think is so much more instantly, I care about this person, like quickly and easily, because they were able to just sort of build him from the ground up. With Dune, you kind of are working within the novel constraints where Frank Herbert was a writer in the 60s. And I think that, yeah, things have changed in terms of like, what do we want from our main characters? What do we, you know, the evolution of that main character, the white savior trope and all that stuff. I can see how Denis is, he's building to that, probably. I think this movie is sort of setting itself as like a subversion of some of those things. But I said this in my review. I think that it's because it's half a movie, and we don't get the other half, I'm just sort of left with what I got and what I received. And what I received is promising, but it's not a movie that I find myself like anxious to keep going with. I will see the next one because I'm invested enough and I want to support, just on my own personal basis, I want to support movies like this. I think more movies like this should come out. And yeah, I wish, though, I think Blade Runner 2049, I wish that had been more successful, because that to me is like, that's the slam dunk. Like, that's the one that I think I felt way more immersed in that movie compared to this one. I felt way more invested in and clued in. So it is kind of strange to me that this is the one that's like striking a chord with people. I don't know if it's because people love Chalamet or if it's because I wonder if it's just the nature of where people are at in 2021, honestly. They feel like, and also because it is the beginning of a franchise, whereas like Blade Runner did have a barrier to entry. You kind of said before, it's like, oh, Blade Runner is this big thing. Not really. Like most people haven't seen the first Blade Runner outside of people who love cinema.
I'm going to have to push back, but I get what you're saying.
I don't know about that. I think people have seen Blade Runner. It's not like a cult film or anything like, it's not that, but it's not necessarily like, I don't think it's the kind of movie that a ton of people have seen or feel like they've seen recently enough to be like, well, I'm going to see the sequel. Whereas like Dune, I guess it's easier to just sort of get into. It's like, it's the first one. And you're like, oh, here's a new big thing. We're coming out of a pandemic. I'm ready to go to the movies to see some, like the start of something new. I want something new because lately everything big that's been coming out has been a replication of something else. It's been a Godzilla movie. It's been another Suicide Squad. Okay. You know, it's this new Marvel movie that's going to do Marvel stuff. You know, I wonder if that's why Free Guy was such a big success, right? Because Free Guy was like, hey, new thing. And Ryan Reynolds, I like Ryan Reynolds, but it's a new thing. It's a new story and it's big and it looks like they actually spent money on it. So I'll go see it.
Yeah. I mean, it's because I think there are a lot of reasons. I think it's, you know, like you said, Denis Villeneuve has a proven track record. I think it's because, you know, they've made a big point being like, you're doing yourself a disservice if you don't see us in theaters. It's also, I think, because to simplify it, it does look like moody Star Wars. You know, it's just like it's Star Wars, but like a little bit more adult or a little bit heavier. And I think, it's an amalgamation of things. I also think it's the fact that people are getting more booster shots and feel more comfortable going to the theater to see it. I think that's very big reasons why people are coming out. But I guess for me, where I found myself surprised was that I was expecting the first half to be a bit of a slog, and then like I'd be more won over with the second half, whereas I think it was more the opposite. Like I think I was really impressed with how big and grand the movie is for the first 2 hours, and then I felt the weight of it in like the remaining 30 minutes. Maybe that's because that started to get into the stuff I haven't read in the book and all that, but I found like that was where like the heaviness of it was kind of coming in, because I was kind of wondering like, okay, at what point are they going to stop and we're going to be like part two? Because it kind of felt like it could at any moment just like cut off. And I get why they ended it where they ended it. Like I think thematically, without getting too much into spoilers, I get like that's like the turning point for Paul, and like that's like the point where he becomes truly like a man, and like the second half is going to be like the Mod Dib stuff, or however you pronounce that. I think it makes sense what they're doing with this, and it does feel like very heavily storyboard, probably to a fault, in that like it kind of feels like you're going through the motions towards those scenes, because it's like, this is the setup, all right, but don't get too attached, you know, we still have 4 more years before we're going to get the second film. So maybe that's the reason why I was kind of starting to drift out of it towards the end, because I felt like I didn't want to get too heavily attached to what was going on. But at the same time though, I just really appreciate and respect what Denis Villeneuve was able to pull off. And I think it's not a simple task in the least to say that, you know, making this even the least bit successful or accessible, I mean, to wide audiences is a huge feat. And even though, like, you know, like they're simplifying it and threading it together in a more approachable way, I think the fact that he's able to keep the core foundation and be faithful to the book in so many respects while making this a big, huge blockbuster that is bringing a lot of people to the movie theater is just a really big deal. And I have to admire that for a lot of reasons.
Yeah, I'm with you there. I really am. And I real quick on the performances. I mean, I think some of the characters are much better than others. I think the only times this movie really had me by the chin was when we were with Oscar Isaac or Rebecca Ferguson. Like whenever the movie was sort of about their differing parenting styles and just like how Paul is like being influenced by both of them, that's when the movie kind of really worked for me. And I liked both of them a lot in this. Chalamet's okay. I don't have issues with his performance generally. But other than that, yeah, I some of the other characters are in here for sure. But I didn't really click with anybody else in this movie for the most part. I think like Josh Brolin kind of just, I feel like we were missing something with him almost. Like there should have been a little bit more to his character or something, but we get fun stuff with him. It's not like this movie is like lacking, you know, Duncan Idaho. He gets some cool moments too.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if you agree with this or not, but I think outside of Aquaman, I think Jason Momoa is just better as a supporting actor. Like, I think he's able to be more charismatic and fun in roles like these. And I think that's where I appreciate him more, at least. But yeah, I do agree with you, because I like Gurney in the book. I believe that's Josh Brolin's character in this. And I felt like they took a lot of his stuff out in this film. So I'm hoping that means that he plays a bigger part in the second film. But yeah, I mean, I don't think any performance like blew me away, but I didn't think anyone did a bad job. I guess for me, my central complaint of the film, and I'm not sure if you agree with this or not, is that I wish, even though I understand why they took the tone they took, I kind of wish that Denis Villeneuve had more of a sense of humor in his films. Like, I kind of wish that he was, even though this movie is willing to be very weird and bold in many respects, I feel like the one thing that the Lynch movie has, that it's able to be a lot more goofy and kind of like absurd in a cheeky sort of way, because it's this like giant weird space movie. And, you know, like, I think, you know, like Star Wars, I understand, like, that's what's able to make it, I think, appealing, is that they have like these weird far out worlds, but they're funny and silly at the same time. And I think for me going into this, I do kind of wish it had maybe a little bit more of a sense of humor, but I do wonder at the same time, if they had put more of that stuff in, it would have been like the Marvel-y, like, well, that happened sort of thing. And I don't want that at all. So, you know, maybe I'm asking for the wrong things, but at the same time, you know, when you're in a 2.5 hour, very heavy, very self-serious film like this, you do sometimes have to wonder if, like, maybe they could have cracked a joke or two, you know, it doesn't hurt.
I don't know. I wonder too, if it would have fit. And if it would have felt right, but who's to say?
I mean, the spit joke was funny. Like, I was like, the one joke I actually remember in the film, I was like, yeah, it's pretty funny. It's a good spit joke.
I'm so curious how it's a heck of a thing how this movie's coming out around the same time as Eternals. Eternals comes out in a couple weeks, and I feel kind of bad for Eternals coming out after this, because these are two movies that are around the same, like, they're within 2 minutes of the same runtime, but. And then they have like such big, like, what if we did the Bible, but in a kind of like adapting like a very old archaic archetype of a story, but putting like big visual flourishes on it. I think ultimately Dune is way more successful, even though it's only like half of one story, whereas Eternals is trying to do like all this stuff. It's trying to cram all of this lore and everything in. And yeah, I wonder how people are going to compare the two films moving forward. I really am curious. Like, it's so weird that we got both of these at like the same time.
Yeah, I didn't really think about it, but I have seen, I mean, without getting ahead of ourselves, I have seen some of the early reactions to the film, and they seem more negative than your average Marvel film, which is a shame, because this was one of the few Marvel movies I was looking forward to. But I do wonder, now you bring it up, if it's because Dune is coming so shortly on its heels and people are just kind of like, well, we have Dune, like, you know, like, what are you doing around here?
Yeah, it's weird. They're different movies for sure, but they have similar, like, they have these weird similarities, like things like how with Eternals, I'd say with like with the directors, like Chloe Zhao and Denis Villeneuve have been known of, like, they're really good at, you know, they pick really good cinematographers. I know Roger Deakins did Blade Runner. In this movie, in Dune, we have Greg Fraser,
the guy who did Rogue One, I believe, right?
That's correct. Yep. And I kind of like how he also did Zero Dark Thirty and Vice.
Yeah, but nice looking movie, I gotta say.
sure.
And one thing I do want to mention is that Chloe Zhao, I mean, has mentioned like one of her influences for Eternals was Denis Villeneuve. So, you know, that's another factor, I guess, in its cap.
That's the thing. It's like they're both directors who they're kind of freshmen. You know, they've been working for like the last good minute. Like, I think Villeneuve has made films a little bit longer than Zhao. I think her first film was like 2015. His was like 2010. But they're in like that same like new kids on the block sort of style filmmaking. They both very much prioritize big landscapes and filming at different times of day and just not doing the usual shortcuts in terms of how do we make this movie feel alive. They really like try to put like their own stamps on it, of course. And I think Zhao is much better at character building, in my opinion, than Denis Villeneuve. I think she's so much better at like exploring like what's the heart of this person? Like what do they bring to the table? And yeah, I that's a little precursor, I think, to like how is this going to compare to Eternals, because they're movies where like it's almost like if you took Dune, you took Internals, and you put them together, you'd have like the perfect movie almost, because they kind of like are like opposites in some ways. But anyway, are we ready to play our little game? Guess the Rotten Tomatoes score.
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah, yeah. Have you seen the Rotten Tomatoes score for Dune the day we record this?
I have not recently. I don't think I've seen it past like the beginning of last week.
Okay, yeah. So you only got a little bit of a peek in through the window. So let's see how you do. So let's start with the critics' score on Rotten Tomatoes. Your hint is that 340 reviews have been counted. People are watching Dune and they're logging their reviews. They're not waiting around. 340 is quite a lot after just a week, weekend. So Will, what do you think?
I'm gonna go high because it seems like people are liking the film more than not. I'm gonna say I'm between like 89 and 94, so I'm gonna split the difference and say 92%.
Oh, you're a bit off. It's 84%.
Oh wow, okay.
I was surprised too.
Makes sense. Yeah, that makes sense.
I would have guessed around the same as you. I was, because when I opened the page up, I was expecting something in the high 80s. So 84 was a little bit of like, oh, huh, yeah, that's kind of low. I'm very curious about that.
I had kind of the hunch that was like, well, you know, it is a bit inaccessible in some respects. So, you know, there's probably like a handful of people, especially if you said like 300 people are talking about it, you know.
Sure.
There has to be at least a handful of people who are like, I don't know about this.
Well, I glanced around. It's kind of like the highbrow critics, like the New Yorker review is negative, you know. So I guess that's where we're finding like some people are just.
Space, how droll.
Richard, it's a Richard Brody thing. We know what he does. Yeah.
I like actually like Richard Brody. I can understand why he doesn't like this film.
Exactly. Yeah. It's just sort of it's not a surprise. I guess we'll put it that way. Not say anything negative about the man. But what about audience score, Will Ash? Audience scores, there are a lot of verified ratings, 2,500 plus, because it's on HBO Max. So, and people are watching it in theaters. So people are watching this. But what do you think the audience thinks?
I'm a little off with my critic score, but I'm going to go and say 94% again for audiences.
Okay, that's a bit closer. It's a 91%.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. So 84 critics, 91 audience. So we're seeing audiences skewing a little bit more positive, and I think that makes sense. I think audiences, like casual moviegoers, tend to see fewer big budget sci-fi films. So I could imagine seeing this as somebody who's like, maybe you haven't seen Blade Runner 2049, maybe you haven't seen 2001, A Space Odyssey. You've just seen like a handful of sci-fi films. So like seeing this would probably be like, whoa.
Yeah, I've seen sand in space, but not like this.
Yeah. I mean, it's like A New Hope, but
yeah.
Chalamet. Yeah.
Great.
So that makes sense. I definitely see why people really like this. And I do like that it's picking up steam to like critics are, there's not like a big backlash to this movie. Critics are like, man, I loved this. And they're happy to say they loved it. They're not being like guarded about it. Right. They're not being like, oh, I liked it, you know?
Yeah. No, I mean, it's, you know, like there is stuff about this movie I don't like and like think I don't like love the film, but I feel like I want to champion it because I like seeing movies like this do well and succeed. So like, I mean, I'm happy to support it. So I can get that mentality for other folks as well.
Last, we'll guess the cinema score. What do you think the cinema score for this one is?
Cinema score, B plus.
Close, A minus.
Okay.
It's been a while since you got the cinema score head on. It's a tough one, though.
So. Yeah, I mean, I can't get those Vegas folks. I don't understand them or want to understand them.
Okay. All right. Well, that is Dune, which is out right now in theaters on HBO Max for the next 27 days or however long, limited time, basically. It is 156 minutes long. So if you are going to check it out, definitely plan accordingly. Let's move on to our next film here. A decisively different film compared to Dune, that is for sure. Let's talk about The French Dispatch. The full title of this, I think, is The French Dispatch of the Liberty, Kansas Evening Sun. If you could probably already tell by the title of the movie, oh, is this a Wes Anderson movie? And you'd be right. This is the 10th film by Wes Anderson, as you already mentioned at the top of the show.
Yeah,
it
probably
is,
the most Wes Anderson movie we've gotten to date, I have to say, right?
I've heard other people say that, but I don't know. I think
you think Fantastic Mr. Fox is more Wes Anderson?
No, actually, no, I wouldn't say that. I'd say it's between Life Aquatic and maybe I'd have to really think about it. But
yeah, I think Life Aquatic is probably the most divisive, but I don't know if it's the most Wes Anderson film.
I've heard some people say Bottle Rocket is. Again, I've never seen Bottle Rocket's the one Wes Anderson I have not seen.
Actually, yeah, same here. That's the only one of his I haven't seen.
Right, yeah. And I like all of his movies. Like, there's not a single one of his movies where I'm like, that was not worth the time I put into it. Like, that's never happened with me before. But that's not to say that I love all of these. There's a couple that I love. There's a bunch that I like. And the last one that I loved was Moonrise Kingdom. And I think a lot of people, though, they'll say the last one they loved was Grand Budapest Hotel. That was a big hit.
Yes, I'm with critics a big and fans. Big fan of Grand Budapest.
I think it's in between like and love for me. I really like it. But it's not, it's not a movie that I look back and I'm like, whoa.
Yeah. See, that's how I feel about Moonrise Kingdom. Like, I like Moonrise Kingdom, but it's not like my favorite Wes Anderson film.
Funny. That's funny how that works. Yeah. But that's the thing. It's like with Wes Anderson, he is such a specific filmmaker. He has such a specific style or series of styles. People know him for certain things. But when you look at it, like, his movies tend to be very different. You know what I mean? Like, they employ a lot of the same things, but they do so many different things that I think his movies do sort of reflect a spectrum of taste. So I talk to people and like some people is like, my favorite is Fantastic Mr. Fox. My favorite is Grand Budapest. Mm-hmm. You might meet somebody on the street who's like Darjeeling Limited. And you're like, okay. And you kind of like walk away.
I actually
really
like Darjeeling Limited.
It's just a funny one to pick as your favorite. That's all.
Right. As your favorite, that'd be an odd choice. I have to admit. Yeah. I would actually be genuinely concerned if that's someone's favorite pick. Like, they might be not doing great.
Your favorite Wes Anderson movie does say a lot about you, I think. I think it says a lot about your film taste, what you look for in a story. Like, when I meet people who are like, my favorite is Rushmore, that says a lot to me about like, I could see why Rushmore hit you. You probably watched it the right time. You probably watched it when you were a teenager, college. Yeah. Well, I'd say young teenager, you know, like 19, 18.
Yeah, I mean, I saw it as a teenager. That is my second favorite Wes Anderson film. You told me which one's your favorite, but I forget. My personally is Well, I don't even know what I was trying to say. My favorite is Royal Tenenbaums.
Oh, man. Yeah. Royal Tenenbaums, it kind of comes up for me sometimes. Where I'm like, oh, is Royal Tenenbaums my favorite? Or is it Moonrise Kingdom? Yeah, it's tough. Isle of Dogs was his last movie. And that was his return to stop motion animation. He had, of course, done Fantastic Mr. Fox, which a lot of people really loved. I like Fantastic Mr. Fox. Good movie. I know you really like Fantastic Mr. Fox, right?
Yes, I love Fantastic Mr. Fox. My third favorite of his. Like, those three, I just think are just wonderful films. I really, really like Royal Tenenbaums. I really like Rushmore, and I really like Fantastic Mr. Fox. And I mean, the other ones I have enjoyed to various extents. The only one I'm kind of iffy on is Life Aquatic, but I think I just need to rewatch it. I don't think I really got it at the time. But I think like you said before, he just has a style that borrows a lot from other people, but it feels so singular to him, and it's so identifiable, but it also is accessible in a way that I think a lot of other filmmakers who are idiosyncratic in these respects can't really be for some reason or another. But I think his style has been mimicked a lot, but I don't think anyone's quite got it the right way that he has gotten in his films. And you know, even as the films have gotten more fanciful, I think the core components of what makes the films great have remained in his work. So, yeah, I like his stuff a lot.
I really do, too. And I think it's tough to pick. Like, sometimes you got to look at his movies, and if you're like recommending, like, okay, you've never seen Wes Anderson, what do you start with? Because some of his movies are more accessible than others. Others are like, you probably should watch a few before you get to this, because it might be like trying to drink scotch before you've ever had a beer, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, I would not. I would say if you've never seen a Wes Anderson film, probably don't start with French Dispatch. Because
I could see somebody getting into it, but I'm not sure like what that would be like.
I mean, so this is probably the one that borrows the most from like kind of like absurdist, like Mel Brooks-y kind of comedy. So I understand where you're coming from, but at the same time, it is so Wes Anderson-y, like even beyond like Isle of Dogs and Moonrise Kingdom and the other films we mentioned, that I feel like it would be a harder sell for someone who is not already subscribed to his brand and his style of filmmaking.
They're not already subscribed to his Dispatch? Yeah. Okay.
There you go.
I deserve that silence.
Sure.
Right. So Wes Anderson, we can safely say we're fans of his work by and large. And with the French Dispatch, and I'm, by the way, I am excited that this is technically the first time you and I are really getting in on a Wes Anderson film, because when Isle of Dogs came out, we were doing Cinemaholics. It was a thing. Mm-hmm. However, you were not on the show for that movie.
Yeah, I think that's the first one of our conversations I missed. And I remember being disappointed, but I had forgotten until you reminded me that I was not actually in that conversation.
Yeah, yeah. I know you mentioned like what you thought of Isle of Dogs later on. Like you came back on the show and you're like, hey, I'm back. And then, you know, you were like, okay, here's what I thought. But I talked about Isle of Dogs with Maverick Hines, former co-host of the show, and we both liked it quite a bit. And I think I've soured on the film a little bit in the waning years. I kind of look back on it and I like that movie, but I definitely like, it's funny because I re-listened to the conversation of that one as well. And Maverick and I, we talked a lot about like the backlash and the discourse around this movie. Oh, simpler times. In terms of, you know, there was some negative reaction to how this movie was handling Japanese appropriation and stuff like that. It's not our best conversation in terms of like what you get out of it. But in terms of like the movie itself, I think that I still look back and I'm like, man, it's so cool that movie exists and that he was able to make it. And it's such an original idea. All that stuff was really, really smart and fun to see and clever too.
Yeah. I mean, I think my expectations for it were maybe a little too high. I put it on the lower end of his filmography just because I think it's good. I enjoy it, but it doesn't scratch the same itch that I think his other better films get. So that's just me, though.
I think that's where I land too. I think when I first saw it, I was really over the moon about it. Or not over the moon, but I was much more positive on it than I am now. And yeah, I think part of that too was like the expectations playing a little bit of a game there as well. French Dispatch, I don't think that same thing's going to happen. I came out of this one really digging it, and that has not waned at all yet. So this movie is a little bit more of an anthology. It's not a total anthology. And so if you don't know, an anthology, we're just saying that it's a bunch of stories in one. It's not, and they're all sort of like disconnected. They're not the same, you know, they don't have the same actors. They're kind of like just a group of short stories in one movie. Mm-hmm. That said, it's also threading all of these in an overarching fourth narrative where Bill Murray is the head editor of this. It's hard. I don't fully understand this, to be totally honest. That's something that I actually kind of like. It's an insert. It's a newspaper based in France, but it's a Kansas newspaper. Yes.
Which is funny to me.
I know, it's so weird. But it's so quirky. But it's about this fictional town called Ennui Blasé or something to that effect. So literally like boredom, the city.
Yeah.
And really funny title there. We get all the typical Wes Anderson fixings where we explore Ennui in a hyper analog 1975 fashion where the technology is very pastel, where we spend a lot of time with characters like in perfectly symmetrical production, these staged sets, going about their business and living their lives. And that's kind of like where this movie starts. And the French Dispatch itself, it tracks along Bill Murray's character, who he has this team of writers and editors who are putting together what will eventually be the final issue of this. Basically, it's the New Yorker, but somewhere in France. That's kind of what they're doing. It has like the cartoony stuff. It has the personal essays. It has the sort of like lifestyle stuff. It has like a tastes and sounds section that turns into this like very highfalutin, you know, set piece story. There's a whole testament, a whole tribute to an artist who I want to be careful because I don't want to get into too much detail of like what the actual stories are. So maybe we ease into that a little bit more. But there are different storylines that are parts of this magazine brought to life. So that's where the anthology part kicks in. The cast is huge. We have Bill Murray, as already mentioned. Elizabeth Moss, she has a smaller role in this than I thought she would. Tilda Swinton, Francis McDormand, Timothy Chalamet, two movies in 1 week. So that's funny. Jeffrey Wright, who I think is one of the film's MVPs. We also have Adrian Brody, Benicio del Toro, Lea Seydoux, a bunch of others. But yeah, this movie is so over the top. I really, really dug it. This is one of the Wes Anderson movies I love. Like, I unbelievably love. I can't stop thinking about it. I'm so anxious to see it again. I think it just made me feel like a writer again. I felt like, man, when you really write something and you put your heart into it, and like, this is when I think of like stories that I write, this is what I want to imagine. Right. I don't know how accessible this movie is, as we've already kind of alluded to, because it's so specific. But again, I really like when things are specific, because they can just sort of shine on their own merit. It's not trying to be everything for everybody. And that's something that I like about it. But what do you think, Will? I have no idea what you think of The French Dispatch. You went into this movie knowing that I really dug it. So I hope that I did not paint your expectations too high.
Well, I mean, you were very warm on the film, but I knew comparatively this was getting kind of a more muted response, at least by like Wes Anderson standards. Like, I knew it was getting good notices, but like other people were kind of like, I don't know, like people who were already kind of on the fence about Wes Anderson were not being swayed by this film, I'll put it that way. But yeah, I mean, I think because my expectations were more in check, I really appreciated this movie a lot, and I liked it a lot. Maybe not quite on the same level as you, because you seem to be very, very high on it. But certainly, I think I'm very receptive, very warm to the film in a way that I find it kind of odd that people are saying it's cold. Because I do think it's earnest enthusiasm for, like you said, writing and literature and The New Yorker and just writing in general. Like I said, I think is very apparent and very sweet. I think people are just a little put off by how comparatively slight it is. Like, it's obviously a lot frothier than his other films. But with that said, I think something that Wes Anderson has in his movies that his imitators, to various extents, I think don't have, is that all of his movies are very goofy and lighthearted in many respects, and kind of, you know, over the top in many different ways. But they have an underlying melancholy that is apparent either through the characters or the tone, in a way that I feel like most of his movies, or at least better films, focus on kind of like old guards of their profession who find themselves emotionally uneased by the fact that like their way is going out the window, and that the world that they know as they know it is no longer being what they want it to be, and they're kind of wrestling with that sense of inadequacy, or whatever you want to have it. And I mean, I think that's very personal to Wes Anderson. I mean, certainly a lot of his films, I think, even by just design, like, I think the fact that he makes movies the way he does, because like he just likes everything to be very symmetrical, and this is how he wants the world to be, where everything kind of like fits into a neat box and everyone kind of moves in certain ways and all that. And yeah, I mean, obviously with Bill Murray's character, I think that's the main key here, is that, like, you know, obviously in a very literal way, like, he is moving on, like his way of writing or approaching literature is going out the window, and obviously this publication is going under for that reason. And so, like, I mean, there is that underlying melancholy. I think the fact that it is an anthology film prevents it from having a deep, thorough line. But at the same time, I think that is still there in a way that it didn't feel disconnected, as some people, I think, have suggested. I do think the overarching story of it is pretty affecting in a sweet way. But I don't think I find myself as intensely move as I do compared to like Royal Tenenbaums or Rushmore or Fantastic Mr. Fox. But at the same time, I mean, like, a movie of Wes Anderson's that I really, really like, if not like Over the Moon Love, is still like one of the best films of the year, especially this year, because I mean, like, it's just such a breath of fresh air to see a Wes Anderson movie like this, where it's so clear and confident in style, like maybe even more so than ever. It just feels like Wes Anderson knows exactly what he wants in a movie, like what he wants to frame, how he wants things to look, how things are supposed to be presented, in a way that can feel maybe like almost suffocating, like in the sense that, like, I kind of wish the messiness of the characters that were seen in Rushmore and Royal Tenenbaums would come back to him. Like, I feel like everything is maybe almost a little too precise at this point, but at the same time, I don't really want him to change his style, because I really enjoy seeing films like this that are so at peace with his vision and so clearly coming from his mind. So despite any criticisms I have, I really did enjoy this a lot, and I was very glad to see, especially in an underwhelming movie year such as this one.
I'd say that criticism about the characters is true for some, but not all. I'd say that Benicio del Toro's character, who is this asylum painter.
Yeah, he's great. And I like that he like stands out, because like the way that Benicio del Toro approaches his character is so clearly different than how like the Wes Anderson regulars approach it, in a way that's really, really refreshing, I find.
Yeah, I agree completely. And also Frances McDormand. I think those are the two, and Jeffrey Wright. Those are the three.
I was going to say Jeffrey Wright was the big one. And
he's kind of doing a James Baldwin.
Sure.
Yeah. They're sort of doing the James Baldwin thing with him, and it's really affecting. He gets like a couple of monologues in this that are like profound. He's a person who like remembers everything he's ever written. And like, that's where the precise thing comes in. I was getting Rushmore vibes a little bit when those three characters were kind of in play, not specifically mm-hmm. like a character in Rushmore was like them, but in terms of like how he approaches a character and better balances the sort of like precision that you're talking you're saying, about with like a quirky.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If Max actually had his shit together, basically.
There we go. Yeah. Yeah. He would basically be, I don't know who he would be in this. I guess Jeffrey Wright, but that's the thing is like, you can't really boil down any Wes Anderson character to just, that's why he can reuse characters as often as he does, because he's so good at writing that you don't see those other characters. Yeah. Yeah. Actors. Thank you. Yeah. He can reuse other actors, the same actors in so many films. Like a lot of people in this movie have never been in a Wes Anderson film, but many of them have. Bill Murray, obviously, Adrian Brody, and obviously I'm blanking, Owen Wilson. But Saoirse Ronan shows up in this. Yeah, Owen Wilson gets a fun little, just like a quick thing in here. Jason Schwartzman gets like not a lot in this movie.
He's basically a cameo, so. But he helped write the screenplay, so obviously he had a big part in this.
The screenplay is fully credited to Wes Anderson, but he helped with the story along with Roman Coppola and Hugo Guinness. But yeah, so all that said, I came out of this movie. It's so funny that people look at it and are saying that it's cold. I've seen some of that reaction as well. I do agree. It's not like the movie has like one punch. Like, it's not the kind of thing where, because it's an anthology, it can't. It just has like small like punches over time. And I remember coming out of the movie and thinking, this is one of those things where it really is going to depend on how much people like the differing short stories. That's what makes it kind of a risky movie, because if you don't like enough of them, then your mind will wander and it will go into too many directions. And I would say that it's so weird because I almost say that the middle section, which is that's where Chalamet and McDormand are, that was probably my least favorite, but it was my favorite in terms of music. I think my all-around favorite was the Asylum one. And then the one that had the most interesting like ending was the third one with Jeffrey Wright.
Yeah. I mean, I think for me, the Jeffrey Wright one was my personal favorite, but the Benicio del Toro one is shortly thereafter. I agree. I think most people have said that the Timothy Chalamet one is probably the weakest of the three or four, if you want to count the Owen Wilson one. I think the main reason I felt the Timothy Chalamet one was a little bit weaker is, for one, it goes on longer, which is deliberate. Like, I mean, there's a big joke about how Frances McDormand overwrites and like overcorrects herself and all that stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
But also, I just feel like I think that segment would have been really interesting if Wes Anderson had more to say politically in that. And I felt like he really didn't. I think he was just kind of commenting more on the like absurdity of like these young people being so politically active and using like a literal like chess game, which is a fun set piece. But like, I just felt like his political commentary in there wasn't really like striking or like pointed in any particular respect. Do you disagree with that though?
I don't disagree at all. I think that it's the weaker one, but I think where it still pulled me in was the musical cues. I don't think Wes Anderson gets enough like credit, honestly, for how good his music tastes are. And I know the music itself is by Alexandre Desplat, but just in terms of his movies on a whole tend to have just really good sounds, like really good tunes kind of filling in the blanks. And this was one of my favorites in that respect. I think that there's a cue in this involving like a jukebox and like the stage opening up. I'm like, that's when I'm feeling this movie's vibe in like every possible way. But compared to the other ones though, it does sort of like fall a little bit short. Although seeing Timothy Chalamet and Frances McDormand kind of do their thing together was—I'll admit, like that kept me interested. That kept my mind from wandering off.
Sure. As far as like the soundtrack thing, I have to agree as well, because I just imagine every time like there's a song cue, I just imagine Wes Anderson in his like twee button-down suit just going to his big vinyl collection of like ruppled like 80s vinyls and just being like, "Nah, this one, I don't
too mainstream."
And he just picks one. It's just like, perfect. And he just puts it on his little like old timey vinyl player. And he's just like snapping his fingers, just like, that's the tune.
That's the thing is like, just you describing that, he's just such an infectious person. The things that he finds interesting are so different from what other people find interesting. But he's just that interesting person that makes you like the thing that he likes. I feel he tries to do with his movies.
Yeah. Like I said before, like, you know, like some filmmakers, like they have a certain tone in their films, and then you like see them in real life, and it's just like, oh, that's like totally different. Like someone like John Waters, just like he makes like these kind of grummy, dingy movies, but he's like very posh and like well put together and all that, and speaks eloquently and all that. And then you have somebody like Wes Anderson or Tim Burton, where you just look at him, just like, yeah, you look like you exist in your own movies. And like Wes Anderson, I think like the way I see it is just like, I think he wants to live in his world. Like, I think he wants the way he makes his movies. I think the Keyist wants that to be the way the world is. And he's almost sort of frustrated. Just like, why can't things be like this? I want things to be like this. Exactly. It's like, he has this very meticulous dollhouse where he just like, he lives in that world, and he's thankfully able to project that onto millions of screens and, you know, get a lot of people to enjoy it as well. But yeah, I mean, it just kind of feels like he sees the world in a very, asymmetrical way, but a very precise and delicate sort of way at the same time. And I certainly enjoy living in his weird little headspace.
Yeah, that's a big reason why I think there is a learning curve to his movies. Because if you go into one of his movies not understanding that he's a fantasy writer, like he's writing fantasies, then you might be like, this is so weird. This is not how the world is. You might have an adverse reaction because you're expecting something else. But if you start with something like, I'd say like one of his stop motion ones, it's probably a good one to start with. Rushmore is a good one to start with. You get hints that he's operating in his own, like you said, dollhouse or sandbox, whatever you want to call it. And he's not trying to present the world as it is. I think it's exactly what you said. He's trying to present the world as he wishes it was. And it's easy, at least for me, to want to be in that world. And because we only get a movie from him every so often, it's like I get to go on a new vacation to a new place that is like this other place that I really like, because it's so hard to describe. It's like there's a new exhibit at the Wes Anderson amusement park. It's probably like an old-timey carnival. And
a museum exhibit or something, just kind of just like, oh, what is this artist doing now? Oh, okay, that's cool.
Yeah, sure. That's fitting, considering Del Toro is a...
Yeah, exactly, movie. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I think we can't say enough about how sharp the writing is in this movie. I mean, it's just the dialogue, the quips, the precision of the narration. It's much stronger, I think, than in Isle of Dogs. There are quotes I actually remember in this one a little bit more profoundly. And there, like, for example, like I think the big one for me is like Bill Murray's is like, just try to make it seem like you wrote that on purpose. You know what I mean? Right. Like, that's such a great line. There's lines like that all over the place. You can tell, like me, I was an active participant in this movie. I was laughing, you know, after the screening, the publicist was like, what do you think? I was like, you sat like right next to me. You know what I thought of this movie. I couldn't stop laughing. It'd be funny though
if you were just like, yeah, it was okay, I guess.
yeah, it could have been funnier. but French Dispatch, good movie.
Right. Well, I mean, to your point about the writing, I think it, like this film especially, it, like the writing had to be so meticulously combed over, because that would be the key, you know, takeaway, because it's such a film about writers. Like if the writing wasn't up to snuff, then like what are we doing here? I think for me, my big thing is, I made this joke already on Letterboxd, but I think I like to think Wes Anderson's approach to this movie is just like, what if a New Yorker cartoon was funny? Like that's like my takeaway. And I think he succeeded. I think it's a very fun, you know, clearly so indebted to New Yorker, but like you said, also clearly loving and respecting of other famous authors and writers from, you know, either Wes Anderson's past or just in literature in general. And yeah, it's just, I can see why people are, you know, down as far as like, it's not as emotionally gratifying, I think, as his other films, just because it's not really trying to be. But I don't think it's cold in any respect. I think it's very lovingly put together. I don't think Wes Anderson ever remotely even half-asses a film. Like, he clearly puts everything he has into making everything exactly right. And maybe that prissiness can be a little too much at times. Like I said, I kind of missed the messiness of his earlier films. It's just in terms of like having characters who were a little bit more unlikable or a little bit more hard to decipher. But I think he's just really on top of his game as far as like making the movies he wants to make and knowing his style and knowing how to get his style down and playing with styles and tones and aspect ratios and animation versus live action. And just, it's, yeah, you just get a wallop of good stuff in here. I find it hard, if you're a Wes Anderson fan, to walk away disappointed, at least fully.
a bit of a warning. This is not for kids. and parts of it for sure would be fine for kids, but a lot of it actually. But there are a couple of scenes involved, one of them involving Leia Seydoux, that if you are younger than like 15, probably, I don't know. I don't know how parents do.
I was watching R-rated movies when I was like 10 or 12. So
I know we were, but I want to be sensitive. Like, not all kids do that. So I don't know. I have a nephew around that age, and I would not want him to watch this movie, unfortunately.
Sure. I mean, if you have young kids, I mean, I think Fantastic Mr. Fox in general is just a good intro. If you have no familiarity with Wes Anderson, just like, where do I begin? I think Royal Tenenbaums and, like you said, Rushmore are great as starting points. But also, I think if you're younger and just want something more accessible or something that, you know, you can watch with the whole family, Fantastic Mr. Fox is a great starting point.
Yeah, and then you can move into Moonrise Kingdom. I think that one's a good one, too.
Yeah, sure. That's a good for all, you know, ages. One, too. Yeah.
Sure. So that's it. I don't want to leave French Dispatch without getting into one of the most important things about the movie, I thought, which is that, so I'm watching this movie and I'm thinking to myself, all right, do I love this movie because it's set primarily in a time that I'm very fond of and it's about things that I'm very fond of? Or is it because it's just sort of like, let me put it this way, because I want to make sure I say this without giving anything away. Is the reason I've had issues with Wes Anderson films in the past because they've been too long with these characters? Like, is the reason that Fantastic Mr. Fox doesn't do it for me as much, is it because it's just like the same characters over one movie? And do I like French Dispatch more because they're short stories? So like, does it work better for me with Wes Anderson when it's just sort of a little bit of each thing, instead of like overstaying its welcome? Does that make sense? Because I like Wes Anderson a lot, but I think a thing that I've noticed in all of his movies for me has been, at some point, I always feel like I've had enough. Like I've eaten, it's a delicious meal, but I've gotten too much. Whereas sure. With French Dispatch, there's such a variety. They're like self-contained stories that I just go from one to one, and I'd never felt overwhelmed, if that makes sense. But it seems to me like other people are feeling overwhelmed, so I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I'm somewhere in between in that I get what you're saying, and I think in some respects I agree, but at the same time, I think because it's so overloaded with like characters and stories and all that, I think I was a little bit more overwhelmed than I was with, say, like Grand Budapest Hotel. But at the same time, I mean, that's not a negative. I think it knows when to get in and get out, like as far as like it doesn't overstay its welcome as far as being like 100-something minutes, and you know, by the end of it, I was really taken by, and I would gladly watch like another 10 or 20 minutes of it. But yeah, for me, I guess the film I guess this is the easiest for me to compare it to is The Ballad of Buster Scruggs, which the Coen brothers did for Netflix a few years back.
Yeah,
because just like for me, like I don't think The Ballad of Buster Scruggs is like a top 10 Coen brothers film, or maybe at least not a top 5 Coen brothers film, but I really, really like it a lot because it just has everything I want in a Coen Brothers film in one film. And if I just like want to like see like the essence of Coen Brothers greatness in one film, I would just watch that film, you know, just because I think it's accessible and obviously, you know, it's segmented so I can break it off and chew it in different little segments. But I don't know if I'm as hot on French Dispatch, but I think I like it for the same reasons, because, you know, because it's an anthology film, you just get like everything you want from a Wes Anderson film. Maybe if it had a little bit more stop motion, I would be happier. But, you know, that's not here nor there. There is some stop motion here throughout.
There's 2D animation, which I was thrilled by. Oh, yeah. So lovely.
Right. I love that wrestler character, by the way, without giving away too much. That joke got me really, really ill. Yeah. Yeah, I think, you know, it's just basically everything you want in a Wes Anderson movie. I mean, maybe not everything, but like a lot of the stuff you want from a Wes Anderson movie. And, like I said, I think if you're a hardcore fan, you're not going to walk away disappointed, because it's just a lot of Wes Anderson in a little package. And, yeah, that's good enough for me.
True enough. Yeah, I think we agree more than we disagree. I just think I have a stronger of the same feelings almost. And it sounds like you share similar criticisms as well. So yeah, we're not too far off, it sounds like.
I think you just got more of like an emotional response, right? Whereas it's like, I was just like, that was delightful. That was really fun. And I don't think I've been like thinking about it as much, but yeah, I really enjoyed the experience of my time watching it, and I would gladly watch it again.
Same here. Let's play our game. French Dispatch, guess the Rotten Tomatoes score. So Will Ashton, your job is to guess the Rotten Tomatoes score. There have only been 165 reviews counted, half that of Dune. But of course, it doesn't hit wide release until later this week, so we won't even be able to do cinema score because there isn't one yet. But we can do the tomato meter the day we record this, as it is right now. Although it's been pretty steady. Did you ever see the critic score, though, before this?
No, I don't think so. Actually, I might have glanced at once.
Okay. What's your guess? What do you think?
I know it's a bit low, but not like super low. Like I know it's below 80%. But I think it's like, I'm going to guess like 76%.
74.
Sorry. Okay, 74.
Very
okay.
Close. Yeah, within 2 points. That's within the margin of error. So 74% on Rotten Tomatoes at 165 reviews. Hey, look. One of those reviews is from me, and I said it was positive. It was the same thing with Dune, too, but I mean, there were so many reviews counted for that, it barely had any impact. But what about the audience score? This would be, if I was doing this, I would struggle, because I never know what audiences are going to think of Wes Anderson movies. That always surprises me. But yeah. We only have 50 plus verified ratings. So we have to, so yeah, I'll let you do the math on that, because there's a lot to consider here, isn't there?
I guess so, yeah. I mean, I did remember when I first saw Moonrise Kingdom, I was kind of just like, I mean, I like this a good bit, but I don't know how other people are going to feel. And I remember, like, the overwhelming consensus was, like, way more positive than I was. And I was just like, whoa, not what I expected. But for this one, like I said, it's not like it's an acquired taste. I just think, like, the fans of Wes Anderson will like it a lot. But I think if people are kind of fed up with Wes Anderson, or if you're kind of getting tired of his style, I think, you know, some people aren't going to be quite as receptive to it. So I'm going to say 68%.
It is 80%. It's a little bit higher. And I think it's because it's in limited release. I think a lot of the people who are coming out to see this are liking what they're seeing, right?
LA crowd.
Yeah,
I got you.
Exactly. Yeah. That's what I almost said that too. I was like, wait, I shouldn't be helping. I can't give you hints. I have to be partial and objective. But I have a feeling it's going to your point. Like, I think you're right. I think once this hits wide release and more people are going to watch it, particularly people in Kansas, I think they're going to watch it and be like, the heck is this? And be kind of a little, who knows though? I hope that's not the case. I would love for this to be a resounding hit. Do you remember though what Isle of Dogs was, Rotten Tomato score wise? Kind of fascinating.
Like right now or at the time?
Right now.
Right now?
Which is pretty similar to what it was at the time.
Is it like 82%?
Much higher. It's 90%.
Oh, 90%.
87%
wow.
Audience score. So
see, I would probably flip French Dispatch and Isle of Dogs, their scores, if I were me.
That's the thing. It's like, well, can we really? I mean, it really does come down to people. It really is just capturing like people who had like a positive reaction. I think with Isle of Dogs, I don't think the average rating is probably that high. I don't think a lot of people came out of Isle of Dogs being like, that was amazing. But enough people were like, that was cool. Like I would be positive on it. Whereas the French Dispatch, I think some people were being like, I'm sick of Wes Anderson. I'm sick of you. You know, like that kind of thing.
Sure.
But I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, we didn't really even talk about how like the like Jacques Tati influence of his films are kind of becoming more and more apparent. I don't remember what exactly the response was at the time.
He's been living
films,
in France, right?
I have to assume so.
Yeah. I mean,
that sounds like what, something like Wes Anderson's doing.
Yeah. I don't know this for sure, but it sounds correct.
I mean, I didn't even bat an eye. I'm just like, that sounds 100% correct.
I'm pretty sure. Yeah. And that's why he has another film that's already in the works too.
Yeah. It's filming.
Yeah, it's filming right now in Chinchona in Spain. So I think that's
dicey compared to, you know, how he's appropriated other countries, but we'll see.
For sure. Yeah. I've heard that this movie, I think it's a little easier with European countries, but yeah, especially
that's
Spaniards.
Fair.
But I've heard that this movie, like if you ever played the game Monument Valley or you're aware of the like art direction, it's like a diorama kind of game. That is apparently what this is supposed to be. So who knows how it will turn out. I hope it's going to be good. I think it's called Asteroid City.
Okay. I didn't know if it had a title yet. I know
it was
that
recently confirmed. Yeah.
I know he's got some new, I think Tilda Swinton's like the lead of it. And I know obviously like Bill Murray is involved, but I believe it's going to be the introduction to Margot Robbie and Tom Hanks being in a Wes Anderson film.
That would be fantastic.
So I'm definitely excited to see those two. Yeah.
Yeah, I hope that's the case. But all right, that is The French Dispatch. It is in limited release right now. You can check it out in theaters. We're going wide later this week through Searchlight Pictures. It's kind of weird to think that this is, that Wes Anderson is under the Disney umbrella for this, but yeah, what are you going to do? The movie is just 103 minutes long, pretty quick runtime. And it's a lowish budget, $25 million. It's like on the low side of midsize, but I don't know about the box office, but that's fine. Wes Anderson is box office proof. Like they'll just keep making movies for him. It doesn't really matter at this point. Maybe down the road,
Yeah, I think this one's going to underperform slightly because, well, for one, I mean, it feels like it's been coming out for like 2 years. Not the film's fault because of the pandemic, but also it just seems like Disney at this point, like they really don't care about their film, like filmmaker driven films. Like obviously, Ridley Scott's Last Duel tanked, and I feel like they might put a little bit more firepower behind French Dispatch, but it also kind of feels like they're just like throwing it out in the middle of, or at the end of October, you know, just kind of willy nilly without much care or consideration.
Well, I don't know. Cause I think there's two things to consider. First of all, this is a time of year where putting out, this is going to be counter programming. You know, this is going to be for a crowd. It's not, you know, they don't really want to see the big budget blockbuster stuff. They might want to see something a little bit more adult like this. So that's fair enough. It's the right season for it. People want to watch prestige films at the moment because it's the fall. I'll say real quick. The other thing is that Wes Anderson typically doesn't release films around this time of year. He likes to release films way earlier in the year.
Yeah.
Summer, spring, sometimes like right after award season. Specifically because he doesn't want to compete with other award season films. And he's like, if my movie is really good, it's going to be celebrated and rewarded no matter when I put it out. Like I think he said that a few times. He did that with Grand Budapest Hotel. I Love Dogs was like a March movie. Yeah. So I think it's kind of interesting that French Dispatch, I think originally was going to be something like that, but then because of Cannes and how the pandemic affected it, it's coming out now.
Yeah. I just feel like if Disney was more confident in it, they would just give this like a Thanksgiving Day weekend release, either in New York and LA or wide. I just feel like that would have been the play. And putting it at the end of October just kind of feels a bit hash.
I disagree there because I think that this is the kind of movie where you don't want this coming out when kids are out of school, because this is a movie that adults need to get a sitter for because they can't take their kids to see it. They know kids won't like it. So if you release it around Thanksgiving, like parent, like who would watch it? Because like, well, we got kids, like how are we gonna, you know, like I can't get a sitter on Black Friday. You know what I mean? I think that's the calculation.
Yeah, because I think, aren't they releasing Encanto on Thanksgiving? That seems like
it's called Encanto.
Sorry, Encanto. Sorry. I know that's like their big Thanksgiving Day play, which makes a lot more sense. It's like their Moana release for this year.
It looks pretty cool. I'm excited to see it. But yeah.
Looks alright.
That's French Dispatch though.
Yeah.
We'll see how it performs as the weeks go by. We have time for one last review here, and we don't have a ton of time, so we might not be able to do like a full-on, like super long review for this one, but that's probably all right. I don't think there's a ton to say, but there is some stuff we should get into with Ron's Gone Wrong.
Oh, no.
I know. I was
You're
scared
devastated.
Going into the movie. I was like, what happened? I hope he's all right.
Yeah.
Ron's Gone Wrong is a computer animated family film. And this is the first film from Locksmith Animation. Locksmith was started in 2014 by Sarah Smith and somebody else. I forget who else. Sarah Smith co-directs this film with Octavio E. Rodriguez. If you recognize the name, that's because Sarah Smith was a co-director of Arthur Christmas.
Yeah, which I didn't realize until after the film, but I was like, oh man, that makes a lot of sense.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
And I love that movie.
Locksmith Animation has gone through a lot of issues because the short history of it is that they were supposed to do a bunch of films with Paramount. That fell through. Then they were going to be doing stuff with 20th Century Fox, but then Disney bought Fox. Blue Sky Studios went away. All of this stuff kind of like resulted in Ron's Gone Wrong coming out kind of unceremoniously by Disney's sort of offshoot of like Fox, but not really, which is 20th Century Studios. Even though 20th Century Studios isn't an animation, it's not Blue Sky, right? It's not known for animation. That's probably why you probably didn't even hear about this movie. It's a very odd time to release
an animated movie because it's October, kids are in school, as we were kind of just discussing earlier. And you do kind of get the sense that they're probably burying this because they don't want it to compete with their Marvel stuff. They don't have any big things coming out right now, except like Eternals is coming out, but that's a more adult film compared to some other Marvel stuff, right? And they have Encanto, which we just talked about too, coming out around Thanksgiving. So it's this whole thing, I think, where Disney was sort of like, we have this animated movie, we have to release it in theaters. It makes me kind of sad because I don't dislike this film. I think this is actually a pretty decent film. But the fact that I saw this in theaters, but I didn't see Luca or Soul in theaters. These two Pixar movies that, for me, were two of the better Pixar films we've gotten in a while. And the fact that like that was sent straight to Disney Plus, like not even with premiere access, but like this movie, because of some contracts and some obligations, it does make its way to theaters. It makes me really mad. Like I feel so like I really missed out on something for legal reasons that have nothing to do with the actual movies. So that kind of bugs me a lot. But I also feel for this movie because it's not bad. It really isn't. It's about a kid who lives in, it's like the near future. And this kid kind of like has this like humble background. His dad is voiced by Ed Helms. The kid himself is voiced by Jack Dylan Grazer. His grandmother is voiced by Olivia Colman. And the whole neighborhood, the whole school has these things called B-bots or bubble bots, which are like, it's the future. Instead of cell phones, instead of tablets and stuff like that, what if you just had like a little buddy, a robot, like followed you around and did all that stuff for you, like your own like little personal robot assistant? And yeah, I think that's kind of a cool idea. I don't think it's necessarily what the future will bring, but it was one of the first times I've seen like an implementation of like technology of like what could happen next that I was like, oh yeah, that kind of makes sense. Like did you think that was smart?
I don't know if it was smart. It was, I guess, semi-interesting, but yeah.
Yeah, okay, fair enough. I thought that, yeah, at least it's interesting.
I didn't mean to be so dismissive. Yeah, I thought it was, you know, it was all right.
No, I hear you. But that's basically the setup. And so this kid, I think his name is Barney, he wants a B-bot because all the other kids have one. It's like, I could imagine that's probably what it's like in school right now. If you're like the one kid without like a cell phone, you know, or at least like a smartphone, it's like that can be very alienating because like that's, if all the kids are like connecting with this piece of technology, that's how people are making friends and doing all this stuff. That could be really hard as a kid because you're like, how do I connect with people otherwise? So finally his dad relents and gets him a B-bot. But it ends up being like a broken one that fell off the truck. And that's how we get introduced to Ron, who doesn't play by the rules. Ron is he's a bit of a bad bot in every sense. He never uploaded to this network that guides his programming. So yeah, he's like a total blank slate.
Call J.J. Abrams because we got a bad robot.
How long have you been waiting to say that?
Just now. It came right to my noggin.
Nice. But yeah, he's like all the other robots, like they have skins, they look like other characters. There's even like some Disney tie-in stuff that they do since they can. And what we get though with Ron is like he's naked. He's just a robot. He like wears like a little wool cap that they got from the grandma character. And I think like my big thing with this movie, it's not long or anything. Like it's actually pretty short, but it is structured very strangely where it feels like five episodes of like a kid's show. Does that make sense? Like I was watching this. I was like, this like series of like 20 minutes is an episode of a show. It has a beginning, middle, end, and it's very specific. It's not really structured like a movie three-act structure. It has like two climaxes.
Yeah. I mean, to get to, I guess, my biggest complaint about the film, I felt the structuring of the story was very rigid. Like, it just kind of felt like we had to go through these beats in a way that felt rather perfunctory. Just like, all right, here is the premise, and here is our main character, and here is what he wants, and here is why he can't have it, and here is how he gets it anyway, and here is the conflict, and here is how he deals with that conflict. And it's just like, I mean, obviously, like, this is what storytelling is, but it just didn't really, like, flow in a way that felt very natural to me. It just kind of felt like very, like, screenwriting 101 to me. Like, this is how it's supposed to play out. Yeah, rudimentary, yeah.
I totally agree with that. I think that it's a bigger issue in the beginning of the film. But I think what I'm saying, too, is that it's like the first episode of this show, of a movie, is... all right, the premise, like you said, and then it culminates with he gets the B-bot, but but then something kind of awkward happens. The next episode is like, oh, the B-bot is not what he expected. And it like surprises him. It culminates with him kind of like coming around on the B-bot. The third episode is him training the B-bot to be a better friend. The fourth episode is them getting lost in the woods. The fifth episode is like the actual climax. It's like all this stuff. It's separated out a bit, and I thought it was hard to watch by the end because I felt like I'd gone through so many emotional arcs, and it's not even that the message is bad. Like, the message is interesting. It's just trying to say something as simple as, hey, you know, connect with people better, you know, like try to be in the moment, be present. And the way you treat your friends is important. It's kind of doing the Free Guy thing again, where it's like, you know, artificial intelligence has rights too, like that kind of thing.
Yeah, a troubling message to be sure, but
I know, like, what is with Hollywood screenwriters?
maybe it's because algorithms are controlling our life. Who knows? I think the joke I made to you is just like the moral of the story is that sometimes the tech conglomerate can accidentally do a good thing, which is pretty just an odd takeaway. Yeah, which I think is an odd takeaway for a film like this. But yeah, I mean, I think
literally the tech CEO, by the way, is named Mark, yeah. And it's just. Oh man. Yeah. Oh boy.
Yeah. I like that. Like you see, you know, like the actual bad guy of the film and like his like turtleneck sweater and his glasses and his, combed hair and just like, I wonder who this is supposed to be.
Yeah, it's pretty subtle. Yeah. But it's like, it's so funny how it's like putting your sympathies, but it's supposed to be with the like sort of young millennial, you know, tech, like startup dude in sweatpants, which is just kind of funny considering current events right now. But yeah,
I don't know. I mean, it did weirdly feel like in good ways and bad ways, it felt like a animated film that we would have gotten in like 2007 or something like that.
Yep. Yeah. At least, I mean, I could see this being more of like 2011, 2012, but yeah, because I got Wreck-It Ralph vibes from this, got a lot of Big Hero 6 vibes from this, and even more recently, I was really thinking about what was that movie that came out that was never mind. It'll come to me in a minute.
It kind of reminded me, and this is like a big pull, but did you ever see the movie Robot and Frank?
No.
Okay, that was with Frank Langella.
I remember the poster for that movie.
He begrudgingly like becomes friends with a robot, and like, you know, like he even learns that like a robot can be his friend and all that. And I was just like, this kind of feels like Robot and Frank Jr. in a weird way.
yeah, I could kind
of see
that.
Pretty good movie though. I like that.
Yeah, it's weird because like this movie is not like terrible at anything. I thought the animation was fine. I thought the character design was okay. The only thing about the human design that bothered me were the ears. Like they're like way too big and it's like very distracting.
It it looked like the characters were like meant to be stop motion, but then they designed them for CG. Kind of like that weird, like flush away Arthur Christmas thing going on there.
Well, the co-director, Jean-Philippe Vigny, has worked on not just Pixar stuff. He was a story artist for a few Pixar films like Inside Out and Good Dinosaur and Cars 3. But Jean-Philippe Vigne, he also did a lot of Aardman animation. He was a director, he was an artist and all this stuff. And I could tell like the Aardman inspiration because there were parts of this movie that felt a little bit more like there were layers to the setting, and it made me think Mitchell's versus Machines. That's what I was thinking of earlier that I was going to say.
Oh yeah. 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 I was thinking about that too. Yeah. Just like a lot of robot movies this year.
Yeah. Yeah. But in terms of like the setting of this, I thought, you know, even though Mitchell's versus Machines, Spider-Man and the Spider-Verse, those are the two Sony animation movies that had like really, really cool, like built-in computer animated worlds. But there've been other ones like Over the Moon and Wish Dragon and a lot of it being like direct to Netflix stuff, really, that those, I know you had a fondness for them of like the zaniness and the absurd and like the way they worked, but I thought they were way too smooth. Like they didn't have any texture to them. I actually thought this movie had real texture. Wish Dragon was the main one I was thinking of.
I wasn't crazy about Wish Dragon, but I did. Are you talking about like the Willoughbys? I remember liking that one a little bit more than you.
No, what I was saying specifically, I remember with Wish Dragon, you thought that like the animation, not the movie itself.
Oh, I just like that it was kind of goofier than we kind of get from like even like a studio like Pixar. Like it feels like it was willing to be more cartoony and kind of Looney Tunes-y. And I didn't get that sense though from this movie.
I get that sense from Turning Red, the next Pixar film. That's going to be a little bit more or like Looney Tunes-y. Did you see that teaser for Turning Red?
I have not. I mean, I'm sure okay. before Eternals or something, I'll see it.
Okay. Well, yeah, I don't know if it's playing in any theaters at the moment in terms of trailers, but yeah, anyway, Run's Gone Wrong. I don't have too much else to say about it. I think that it's perfectly fine. Like, do you recommend this? Like, do you think kids should be lining up?
I mean, we've been joking and kind of goofing, but like, I found this to be kind of surprisingly affecting.
Sure.
I think it's like I said, I think it's too rigid in its storytelling and too like by the books as far as like kind of borrowing other animation houses' playbooks to like really stand on its own and be memorable or distinct in any particularly relevant way. But I went in with like extremely low expectations, not because I heard it was bad or anything, just like I just didn't know what this movie was. I hadn't seen any trailers. I just saw the poster and I was just like, whatever, like I feel weird being in a kid's film, but John wants to talk about it. Let's see what this movie is. And you know, like the beginning is just kind of like whatever, it's your kind of like bland setup for a movie like this. But you know, I do think that they get the actual sweetness of Ron and what's his name, Barney, pretty well down. And I think when it actually has the chance for Ron to go wrong in the right ways, it has some really funny beats. There's one in particular about, without giving too much away, about Ron trying to make friends for Barney.
It's my favorite part of the movie.
Yeah. Which is really funny and a really inspired bit of comedy that I think, if the movie was like that throughout, I think the middle segment's where I was most endeared to the film.
I think those jokes probably would have worn out, though. But if they had been that same like level...
Yeah, exactly. If it had more like stuff like that throughout, I think it would have been like, this is like a whatever, like 7 out of 10 type film. I think as it is, I think it's like a really solid, fun, worth recommending, like 6 out of 10 type film. Like decent, like good in its values, even if like some of the commentary is maybe a bit unsettling. But, you know, it's just like well done and nice. It just doesn't really do anything unique or special with what it's doing. And I felt like it could have done more and just chose not to for whatever reason.
I lean a bit positive on it too, but just because I really like Ron. Like Barney's whatever, but like there were so many times where like the way like Ron, like Galifianakis just does a really good job, I think, with the voice. Like the delivery is really funny. I think with some other voice actors it probably wouldn't have worked quite as well, but even just the way that like Ron says no problem, absolute, like there's just something kind of like quirky to his delivery, and it made like repeated jokes still kind of work, even though they were the same joke again.
Yeah.
And yeah, he's just a cute robot. I think it is film school 101. It's like, oh my gosh, it's the robot that's like, it's fun because it's a little bit different. Like, okay, we know what that is, but at least it is doing it effectively, at least in that regard.
Yeah. I mean, affecting, I think is the right word. Like it hits all the expected buttons, you know, pun intended, because it's a robot, but you know, it works. I mean, it's sweet. It's very accessible. I think audiences can like it. You know, it's very cute and innocent in its values. But yeah, I just don't think it does enough on its own to really stand out compared to other films. But at the same time, like I haven't really been keen on any animated films this year for the most part. And I felt like this was no worse than some of the other films that I've heard way higher praise for.
Nonsense.
That's just me, though.
I would say the two. There are three animated films this year that I think is a terrific year for animation.
I thought Luca was good, but
I would say Luca's probably my favorite among them. Mitchell's versus the Machines and CryptoZoo, though, like those three.
Oh, CryptoZoo, yeah, sure. I was thinking like with family animation, but that's a good example.
Okay, yeah, sure. But I know Mitchell's versus Machines you were not as hot on, but I maintain that movie is terrific and easily one of my favorites of the year. And so I think it's a superior version of this one. But that's not to say they're in that much competition. They're very different movies.
Yeah, I mean, my hottest take, and I'll save it for the end of the episode, is I think this is pretty much on par with Mitchell's versus Machine.
I cannot understand. Like, I'm baffled. But you know what? That's what's great about you, Lash, and you keep me guessing. You always keep me, always surprise me in some way. Last thing I'm going to say about Ron's Gone Wrong, though, I legitimately, like, while I was watching this, I was like, oh my gosh, the way that Galifianakis is doing Ron, it reminds me of the way that you do some of, like, the voices on, like, some of the classic Cinemaholics bits. Like, there were times, like, I almost felt like I heard your voice through Ron a little bit. Like,
oh, really?
It's true. Okay. I think it's because I've edited those episodes so many times that, like, I don't know, maybe it's a psychosis thing, but...
You mean, like, where it kind of, like... play into the rhythm of the beat, like, you know, like kind of like just read the lines as like to be expected, like that kind of thing.
I don't know. Yeah, but yeah, basically.
Ron's gone wrong. And if Ron's gone wrong, I don't want to be right.
There you
honestly.
Go.
But good are, baby are we ready
gag
to...
in this. I that's which all gag? I'll say. Good baby gag.
Oh, yes. Very good, high quality.
Good baby. I've been cracking up about that baby gag. Such a good baby gag.
Yeah, you're telling me like you came out of the movie and you're like, man, what a good baby gag. That got me. I got to laugh. Let's play our game. Ron's Gone Wrong on Rotten Tomatoes. And wow. So we did this for Dune and French Dispatch, and it's been like in diminishing order, right? Because Dune had like 340 critics logged it on Rotten Tomatoes, and French Dispatch, which hasn't hit wide, to be fair, had like 160 something. Ron's Gone Wrong only has 73 reviews on here. One of them's mine. So you get a little bit of a hint there.
There you go.
Yeah. I came to bat for this movie. I gave it like just barely passed into fresh for me. Like very, okay. It's like right on the line. And I was like, you know what? I want to give this thing the fresh because I had a fresh time.
Yeah, I think it's a fresh. I would give it a fresh.
What do you think though for the critic score? Out of 73 reviews, it could go either way, right? That's not a lot. Like one negative review, one positive review, it pushes it up a few points.
I'm going to repeat my score for French Dispatch and say 78%.
Even closer than last, 79%. Okay. Oh, so close, Flash. Like if you had done it maybe yesterday, who knows? It might have been right on.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I figured like people aren't like loving this movie. I'm not hearing a lot of buzz for it, but like it seems like it's kind of hard to walk away from this being like, oh, that sucked. Like it's just like, yeah, it's charming. It's, at worst, I feel like you just find it kind of mediocre, but sure. You know, yeah.
I'm kind of glancing at it now. Yeah, I'm seeing like 2 out of 4 here. LA Times wasn't nice to it. Kevin Lee, who is a critic I really like, and he did the Awards Watch review. He really disliked it, you know. And
really?
So, yeah. But, hey,
I guess
what are
you find
do?
Like Ron annoying or something, but like I find it hard to like hate this movie.
I don't know. New York Times though, fresh rating. So anything can happen in this little world of ours. But okay, what about audience score? 250 plus verified ratings. That was more than French Dispatch. What do you think the audiences are leaving this one score-wise?
I think audiences are going to be more favorable than critics, but not overwhelmingly so. So I'm going to say 82%.
You're a bit off. 95%.
Really? They're loving it. Wow.
I think it's the expectation thing, honestly. I think people are not expecting much from this. They're coming out and seeing it anyway because they're like, yeah, you know, nothing else to do. And they're coming out and watching this movie and they're like, hey, this is better than I expected.
I mean, if you have like young kids and you want to take them to a movie, like you're not going to take them to Dune. So it makes sense.
Good, I guess.
I mean, you could. It's PG-13 or whatever, but...
Movies parents took me to. They would have taken me to Lawrence of Arabia if it had come out when I was alive.
Yeah, sure.
Can we go see Ron's Gone Wrong? No. I hope you went to the bathroom. But yeah, 95%, pretty high. What about cinema score?
I don't know. B plus?
A. That's the highest cinema score we've gotten in a while, hasn't it?
Those Vegas folks just love robots, I guess.
Yeah, they're like, Ron's gone right into my heart. This thing, though, oh boy. I know that Locksmith Animation is going to be making a few new films, I think with Warner Brothers next. So they're not going to keep this up with 20th Century. A big reason why I think things kind of have been low-key in terms of the film's marketing. I mean, but
did this do well? Because
that's what I was about
to
say.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Not doing great. $17.4 million since it opened, which for an animated movie, even with the pandemic, it doesn't have a ton of competition, right? Because like, I think its competition is mainly Netflix. It's like, if you're going to watch like a kid's movie with kids, you're probably watching stuff on there.
Is the pandemic, like the COVID. Like kids, true. Parents probably just don't want to
take their kids.
And the time
of year.
Yeah.
Right? It's like, it's the pandemic, but it's also the time of year. It's the fact that, and it's Halloween season. Who's going to the movies? I mean, again, we were weird kids. We probably went to the movies year round. I think I did. But like when I was at the age that I would have wanted to see Ron's Gone Wrong. But most kids aren't like that. Most kids are like, I just want to be on TikTok right now. I don't need to go see this robot movie.
I mean, I don't think this is anywhere near as good as Iron Giant, but it kind of reminds me of the release rollout for Iron Giant, where they're just kind of like, I don't know, when do we put this out? And they just kind of like dumped in the fall and like without a lot of fanfare or notice, and audiences are just like, what is this? It's like a Disney movie. And it's like, no, it's like a
masterpiece. Oh, yeah. All right.
Iron Giant. Absolutely. Yes. It's a masterpiece. Yeah. It's just like, yeah, this is like arguably one of the best animated films of the past, like 25 years. Okay. That's cool, I guess.
you know it's October, right? Actually, I don't remember when Iron Giant was supposed to have come out, but yeah, fair point there. All right, well, that's Ron's Gone Wrong. Hey, quick movie, 106 minutes long, around the same time as French Dispatch. So we had some, I mean, that is a little bit long actually for an animated movie. Usually they're around an hour and a half. This is stretching up a little bit more into like an hour 40, but yeah, that's not bad.
The movie could have calmed down a bit. Like, it was like, and here's something about surveillance. And it's just like, this is a bit heavy for a kid's film. Let's just tone it back a bit, maybe.
They really pushed like that cyberbullying thing, too. It's like, oh, gosh.
Yeah.
That's very 2015.
I don't know if I admire it more for the fact that they're like actually like condemning surveillance, or if they're like the fact they're bringing up at all is kind of weird. But I don't know. That's a whole other discussion.
And it's one that I feel like we could have about other films probably in more detail compared to this one. It's so paper thin. It's like, you know, we would just be talking about other stuff if we tried to get into that tangent. But that is Ron's Gone Wrong. You can watch it in theaters now. And that's it for our show. We are going to be gone in just a second. Next week, we're going to be, I think the plan, this could change. We're hoping to talk about Last Night in Soho. Probably
that's
a bonus.
A given, I think. Yeah.
It might come out before the main show. We don't know yet. So we have some things going on this weekend. I'm going to be out of town. All this stuff's going to be going on. But we are going to be talking about Last Night in Soho. That'll be coming. Also want to talk about Passing. Maybe Antlers? I don't know how Antlers might happen. But I think you saw it, so you'll be talking about it at some point.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if people are really dying to hear what we think about Paranormal Activity, whatever the subtitle is, I don't even know. But if it's, you know, big enough hit that people want to hear our thoughts, I mean, we've talked about it more than I expected. So maybe if there's enough interest for a review, I mean, I'll see it, but I don't know. A bunch of stuff is coming out, though.
It's called Paranormal Activity Next of Kin. That's sure. And it's supposed to reboot the series. That's
of course.
Idea. Yeah.
Why not?
We're done with what we had before.
Make it a TikTok.
I mean, the thing, I looked it up after we talked about it and you were just kind of jamming, but yeah. I didn't know it was produced by Jason Blum, and I didn't know that Christopher Landon wrote it. And that's kind of promising.
Oh, yeah. Well, now I want to see it.
Does that settle it? I don't know. I mean, the director is someone named William Eubank, who I don't think I've seen. I know he did that movie Underwater with Kristen Stewart, but I didn't see that.
I mean, to be fair, Underwater I did see. I think did we not talk about that on the show?
I think I was out for that because that was around Sundance time.
Oh, actually, I think, yeah, you're right, because that was January. Yeah, that was like one of the last films I saw at theaters before the pandemic started. I think Christopher Landon's been involved with at least a few of the, outside of the marked ones. I think he's like written a number of. So I guess he's coming back to the franchise, whatever. That's a whole other discussion.
It's cool to see. Yeah, I hope we can have a Christopher Landon discussion again, considering I think this podcast has, we've shouted this guy out with Happy Death Day and Freaky.
Yeah, of course.
And, you know, here we go. I feel like we're kind of obligated to talk about it now, but who knows?
All right. Well, there you go.
Yeah. All right. Well, that is our show for this week. We'll see you all next time from the Internet California. I'm John Negroni.
And for Internet Pennsylvania, I'm Washington.
See you.